Chapter 11 of Biographia Literaria. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Nicole Lee. Biographia Literaria by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Chapter 11. An affectionate exhortation to those who in early life feel themselves disposed to become authors. It was a favourite remark of the late Mr. Whitbread's that no man does anything from a single motive. The separate motives, or rather moods of mind, which produce the preceding reflections and anecdotes have been laid open to the reader in each separate instance. But an interest in the welfare of those who at the present time may be in circumstances not dissimilar to my own at my first entrance into life has been the constant accompaniment and, as it were, the undersong of all my feelings. Whitehead, exerting the prerogative of his laureateship, addressed to youthful poets a poetic charge, which is perhaps the best, and certainly the most interesting, of his works. With no other privilege than that of sympathy and sincere good wishes, I would address an affectionate exhortation to the youthful literati grounded on my own experience. It will be but short, for the beginning, middle, and end converge to one charge. Never pursue literature as a trade, with the exception of one extraordinary man. I have never known an individual, least of all an individual of genius, healthy or happy without a profession, that is, some regular employment, which does not depend on the will of the moment, and which can be carried on so far mechanically that an average quantum only of health, spirits, and intellectual exertion are requisite to its faithful discharge. 3 hours of leisure, unannoyed by any alien anxiety, and looked forward to with delight as a change in recreation, will suffice to realize in literature a larger product of what is truly genial than weeks of compulsion. Money and immediate reputation form only an arbitrary and accidental end of literary labour. The hope of increasing them by any given exertion will often prove a stimulant to industry, but the necessity of acquiring them will in all works of genius convert the stimulant into a narcotic. Motives by excess reverse their very nature, and instead of exciting, stun and stupefy the mind. For it is one contradistinction of genius from talent, that its predominant end is always comprised in the means. And this is one of the many points which establish an analogy between genius and virtue. Now, though talents may exist without genius, yet as genius cannot exist, certainly not manifest itself without talents, I would advise every scholar who feels the genial power working within him, so far to make a division between the two, as that he should devote his talents to the acquirement of competence in some known trade or profession, and his genius to objects of his tranquil and unbiased choice. While the consciousness of being actuated in both alike by the sincere desire to perform his duty, will alike ennoble both. My dear young friend, I would say, suppose yourself established in any honourable occupation, from the manufactory or counting-house, from the law-court, or from having visited your last patient, you return at evening, dear tranquil time, when the sweet sense of home is sweetest, to your family, prepared for its social enjoyments, with the very countenances of your wife and children brightened, and their voice of welcome made doubly welcome by the knowledge that, as far as they are concerned, you have satisfied the demands of the day by the labour of the day. Then when you retire into your study, in the books on your shelves, you revisit so many venerable friends with whom you can converse, your own spirit scarcely less free from personal anxieties than the great minds that in those books are still living for you. Even your writing-desk, with its blank paper and all its other implements, will appear as a chain of flowers, capable of linking your feelings as well as thoughts to events and characters past or to come. Not a chain of iron, which binds you down to think of the future and the remote, by recalling the claims and feelings of the peremptory present. But why should I say retire? The acts of active life and daily intercourse with the stir of the world will tend to give you such self-command that the presence of your family will be no interruption. Nay, the social silence or undisturbing voices of a wife or sister will be like a restorative atmosphere, or soft music which moulds a dream without becoming its object. If facts are required to prove the possibility of combining weighty performances in literature with full and independent employment, the works of Cicero and Xenophon among the ancients, of Sir Thomas More, Bacon, Baxter, or, to refer at once to later and contemporary instances, Darwin and Roscoe, are at once decisive of the question. But all men may not dare promise themselves a sufficiency of self-control for the imitation of those examples. Though strict scrutiny should always be made whether indolence, restlessness, or vanity impatient for immediate gratification, have not tampered with the judgment and assumed the visage of humility for the purposes of self-delusion. Still the Church presents to every man of learning and genius a profession in which he may cherish a rational hope of being able to unite the widest schemes of literary utility with the strictest performance of professional duties. Among the numerous blessings of Christianity, the introduction of an established church makes an especial claim on the gratitude of scholars and philosophers, in England at least, where the principles of Protestantism have conspired with the freedom of the government to double all its salutary powers by the removal of its abuses. That not only the maxims, but the grounds of a pure morality, the mere fragments of which the lofty grave tragedians taught, in chorus or iambic, teaches best, of moral prudence, with delight received, in brief sententious precepts, and that the sublime truths of the divine unity and attributes, which a Plato found most hard to learn and deemed it still more difficult to reveal, that these should have become the almost hereditary property of childhood and poverty, of the hovel and the workshop, that even to the unlettered they sound as commonplace, is a phenomenon which must withhold all but minds of the most vulgar caste from undervaluing the services even of the pulpit and the reading desk. Yet those who confine the efficiency of an established church to its public offices can hardly be placed in a much higher rank of intellect. That to every parish throughout the kingdom there is transplanted a germ of civilization, that in the remotest villages there is a nucleus round which the capabilities of the place may crystallize and brighten, a model sufficiently superior to excite, yet sufficiently near to encourage and facilitate imitation. This, the unobtrusive, continuous agency of a Protestant church establishment, this it is which the patriot and the philanthropist, who would fain unite the love of peace with the faith in the progressive amelioration of mankind, cannot estimate at too high a price. It cannot be valued with the gold of Ophir, with the precious onyx or the sapphire. No mention shall be made of coral or of pearls, for the price of wisdom is above rubies. The clergyman is with his parishioners, and among them. He is neither in the cloistered cell nor in the wilderness, but a neighbour and a family man, whose education and rank admit him to the mansion of the rich landholder, while his duties make him the frequent visitor of the farmhouse and the cottage. He is, or he may become, connected with the families of his parish or its vicinity by marriage. And among the instances of the blindness, or at best of the short-sightedness, which it is the nature of cupidity to inflict, I know few more striking than the clamours of the farmers against church property. Whatever was not paid to the clergyman would inevitably at the next lease be paid to the landholder, while, as the case at present stands, the revenues of the church are in some sort the reversionary property of every family that may have a member educated for the church, or a daughter that may marry a clergyman. Instead of being foreclosed and immovable, it is in fact the only species of landed property that is essentially moving and circulative. That there exist no inconveniences, who will pretend to assert, but I have yet to expect the proof that the inconveniences are greater in this than in any other species, or that either the farmers or the clergy would be benefited by forcing the latter to become either trullibers or salaried placemen. Nay, I do not hesitate to declare my firm persuasion that whatever reason of discontent the farmers may assign, the true cause is this, that they may cheat the parson but cannot cheat the steward, and that they are disappointed if they should have been able to withhold only £2 less than the legal claim, having expected to withhold £5. At all events, considered relatively to the encouragement of learning and genius, the establishment presents a patronage at once so effective and unburdensome that it would be impossible to afford the like or equal in any but a Christian and Protestant country. There is scarce a department of human knowledge without some bearing on the various critical, historical, philosophical, and moral truths in which the scholar must be interested as a clergyman. No one pursuit worthy of a man of genius, which may not be followed without incongruity. To give the history of the Bible as a book would be little less than to relate the origin or first excitement of all the literature and science that we now possess. The very decorum which the profession imposes is favourable to the best purposes of genius, and tends to counteract its most frequent defects. Finally, that man must be deficient in sensibility, who would not find an incentive to emulation in the great and burning lights which in a long series have illustrated the Church of England, who would not hear from within an echo to the voice from their sacred shrines, et pater aeneas, et avunculus excitat Hector. But whatever be the profession or trade chosen, the advantages are many and important, compared with the state of a mere literary man, who in any degree depends on the sale of his works for the necessaries and comforts of life. In the former, a man lives in sympathy with the world in which he lives. At least he acquires a better and quicker tact for the knowledge of that with which men in general can sympathize. He learns to manage his genius more prudently and efficaciously. His powers and acquirements gain him likewise more real admiration, for they surpass the legitimate expectations of others. He is something besides an author, and is not therefore considered merely as an author. The hearts of men are open to him, as to one of their own class, and whether he exerts himself or not in the conversational circles of his acquaintance, his silence is not attributed to pride, nor his communicativeness to vanity. To these advantages I will venture to add a superior chance of happiness in domestic life, were it only that it is as natural for the man to be out of the circle of his household during the day as it is meritorious for the woman to remain for the most part within it. But this subject involves points of consideration so numerous and so delicate, and would not only permit, but require such ample documents from the biography of literary men, that I now merely allude to it in transitu. When the same circumstance has occurred at very different times to very different persons, all of whom have some one thing in common, there is reason to suppose that such circumstance is not merely attributable to the persons concerned, but is in some measure occasioned by the one point in common to them all. Instead of the vehement and almost slanderous dehortation from marriage, which the misogyn Boccaccio addresses to literary men, I would substitute the simple advice, be not merely a man of letters. Let literature be an honourable augmentation to your arms, but not constitute the coat, or fill the escutcheon. To objections from conscience I can of course answer in no other way than by requesting the youthful objector, as I have already done on a former occasion, to ascertain with strict self-examination whether other influences may not be at work, whether spirits not of health, and with whispers not from heaven, may not be walking in the twilight of his consciousness. Let him catalogue his scruples and reduce them to a distinct intelligible form. Let him be certain that he has read with a docile mind and favourable dispositions the best and most fundamental works on the subject, that he has had both mind and heart open to the great and illustrious qualities of the many renowned characters who had doubted like himself, and whose researches had ended in the clear conviction that their doubts had been groundless, or at least in no proportion to the counterweight. Happy will it be for such a man, if among his contemporaries elder than himself he should meet with one who, with similar powers and feelings as acute as his own, had entertained the same scruples, had acted upon them, and who by after research, when the step was alas irretrievable, but for that very reason his research undeniably disinterested, had discovered himself to have quarrelled with received opinions only to embrace errors, to have left the direction tracked out for him on the high road of honourable exertion, only to deviate into a labyrinth, where when he had wandered till his head was giddy, his best good fortune was finally to have found his way out again, too late for prudence, though not too late for conscience or for truth. Time spent in such delay is time won, for manhood in the meantime is advancing, and with it increase of knowledge, strength of judgment, and above all, temperance of feelings. And even if these should effect no change, yet the delay will at least prevent the final approval of the decision from being alloyed by the inward censure of the rashness and vanity by which it had been precipitated. It would be a sort of irreligion, and scarcely less than a libel on human nature, to believe that there is any established and reputable profession or employment in which a man may not continue to act with honesty and honour. And doubtless there is likewise none, which may not at times present temptations to the contrary. But woefully will that man find himself mistaken, who imagines that the profession of literature, or, to speak more plainly, the trade of authorship, besets its members with fewer or with less insidious temptations than the church, the law, or the different branches of commerce. But I have treated sufficiently on this unpleasant subject in an early chapter of this volume. I will conclude the present, therefore, with a short extract from Herder, whose name I might have added to the illustrious list of those who have combined the successful pursuit of the muses, not only with a faithful discharge, but with the highest honours and honourable emoluments of an established profession. The translation the reader will find in a note below. Am sorgfältigsten meiden sie die Autorschaft, so früh oder unmäßig gebraucht, mag sie den Kopf wüster an das Herz leer, wenn sie auch sonst keine übel Folgen gebe. Ein Mensch, der nur lieset zu drücken, lieset wahrscheinlich übel, und für jeden Gedanken, der ihm oft stoßt, durch Feder und Presse versendet, hat sie in kurzer Zeit alle versandt, und wird bald ein bloßer Diener der Druckerei, ein Buchstabensetzer werden. End of chapter 11. Chapter 12 of Biographia Literaria. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Nicole Lee. Biographia Literaria by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Chapter 12. A chapter of requests and premonitions concerning the perusal or omission of the chapter that follows. In the perusal of philosophical works, I have been greatly benefited by a resolve which, in the antithetic form and with the allowed quaintness of an adage or maxim, I have been accustomed to word thus: until you understand a writer's ignorance, presume yourself ignorant of his understanding. This golden rule of mine does, I own, resemble those of Pythagoras in its obscurity rather than in its depth. If, however, the reader will permit me to be my own Hierocles, I trust that he'll find its meaning fully explained by the following instances. I have now before me a treatise of a religious fanatic, full of dreams and supernatural experiences. I see clearly the writer's grounds and their hollowness. I have a complete insight into the causes which, through the medium of his body, has acted on his mind, and by application of received and ascertained laws, I can satisfactorily explain to my own reason all the strange incidents which the writer records of himself. And this I can do without suspecting him of any intentional falsehood, as when in broad daylight a man tracks the steps of a traveller who had lost his way in a fog or by a treacherous moonshine, even so, and with the same tranquil sense of certainty, can I follow the traces of this bewildered visionary. I understand his ignorance. On the other hand, I have been reperusing with the best energies of my mind the Timaeus of Plato. Whatever I comprehend impresses me with a reverential sense of the author's genius, but there is a considerable portion of the work to which I can attach no consistent meaning. In other treatises of the same philosopher, intended for the average comprehensions of men, I have been delighted with the masterly good sense, with the perspicuity of the language, and the aptness of the inductions. I recollect likewise that numerous passages in this author, which I thoroughly comprehend, were formerly no less unintelligible to me than the passages now in question. It would, I am aware, be quite fashionable to dismiss them at once as Platonic jargon, but this I cannot do with satisfaction to my own mind, because I have sought in vain for causes adequate to the solution of the assumed inconsistency. I have no insight into the possibility of a man so eminently wise using words with such half-meanings to himself as must perforce pass into no meaning to his readers, when, in addition to the motives thus suggested by my own reason, I bring into distinct remembrance the number and the series of great men who, after long and zealous study of these works, had joined in honouring the name of Plato with epithets that almost transcend humanity, I feel that a contemptuous verdict on my part might argue want of modesty, but would hardly be received by the judicious as evidence of superior penetration. Therefore, utterly baffled in all my attempts to understand the ignorance of Plato, I conclude myself ignorant of his understanding. In lieu of the various requests which the anxiety of authorship addresses to the unknown reader, I advance but this one, that he will either pass over the following chapter altogether, or read the whole connectedly. The fairest part of the most beautiful body will appear deformed and monstrous, if dissevered from its place in the organic whole. Nay, on delicate subjects, where a seemingly trifling difference of more or less may constitute a difference in kind, even a faithful display of the main and supporting ideas, if yet they are separated from the forms by which they are at once clothed and modified, may perchance present a skeleton indeed, but a skeleton to alarm and deter. Though I might find numerous precedents, I shall not desire the reader to strip his mind of all prejudices, nor to keep all prior systems out of view during his examination of the present, for in truth such requests appear to me not much unlike the advice given to hypochondriacal patients in Dr. Buchan's Domestic Medicine, vide licet, to preserve themselves uniformly tranquil and in good spirits, till I discovered the art of destroying the memory a parte post, without injury to its future operations, and without detriment to the judgment. I should suppress the request as premature, and therefore, however much I may wish to be read with an unprejudiced mind, I do not presume to state it as a necessary condition. The extent of my daring is to suggest one criterion by which it may be rationally conjectured beforehand, whether or no a reader would lose his time and perhaps his temper in the perusal of this or any other treatise constructed on similar principles. But it would be cruelly misinterpreted as implying the least disrespect either for the moral or intellectual qualities of the individuals thereby precluded. The criterion is this: if a man receives as fundamental facts, and therefore, of course, indemonstrable and incapable of further analysis, the general notions of matter, spirit, soul, body, action, passiveness, time, space, cause and effect, consciousness, perception, memory, and habit, if he feels his mind completely at rest concerning all these, and is satisfied, if only he can analyze all other notions into some one or more of these supposed elements, with plausible subordination and apt arrangement, to such a mind I would as courteously as possible convey the hint that for him the chapter was not written. Via bonus est, doctus prudens, est haud tibi spiro. For these terms do in truth include all the difficulties which the human mind can propose for solution. Taking them therefore in mass and unexamined, it required only a decent apprenticeship in logic to draw forth their contents in all forms and colours, as the professors of legerdemain at our village fairs pull out ribbon after ribbon from their mouths. And not more difficult is it to reduce them back again to their different genera. But though this analysis is highly useful in rendering our knowledge more distinct, it does not really add to it. It does not increase, though it gives us a greater mastery over, the wealth which we before possessed. For forensic purposes, for all the established professions of society, This is sufficient. But for philosophy in its higher sense, as a science of ultimate truths, and therefore scientia scientiarum, this mere analysis of terms is preparative only, though as a preparative discipline indispensable. Still less dare a favourable perusal be anticipated from the proselytes of that compendious philosophy, which, talking of mind, but thinking of brick and mortar, or other images equally abstracted from body, contrives a theory of spirit by nicknaming matter, and in a few hours can qualify its dullest disciples to explain the omne scibile by reducing all things to impressions, ideas, and sensations. But it is time to tell the truth. Though it requires some courage to avow it in an age and country in which disquisitions on all subjects, not privileged to adopt technical terms or scientific symbols, must be addressed to the public, I say then that it is neither possible nor necessary for all men, nor for many, to be philosophers. There is a philosophic, and inasmuch as it is actualized by an effort of freedom, an artificial consciousness, which lies beneath or, as it were, behind the spontaneous consciousness natural to all reflecting beings. As the elder Romans distinguished their northern provinces into Cisalpine and Transalpine, so may we divide all the objects of human knowledge into those on this side and those on the other side of the spontaneous consciousness, sitra et trans conscientiam communem. The latter is exclusively the domain of pure philosophy, which is therefore properly entitled transcendental, in order to discriminate it at once, both from mere reflection and representation on the one hand, and on the other from those flights of lawless speculation which, abandoned by all distinct consciousness, because transgressing the bounds and purposes of our intellectual faculties, are justly condemned as transcendent. The first range of hills that encircles the scanty veil of human life is the horizon for the majority of its inhabitants. On its ridges the common sun is born and departs. From them the stars rise, and touching them they vanish. By the many, even this range, the natural limit and bulwark of the veil, is but imperfectly known. Its higher ascents are too often hidden by mists and clouds from uncultivated swamps, which few have courage or curiosity to penetrate. To the multitude below these vapours appear, now as the dark horns of terrific agents, on which none may intrude with impunity, and now all aglow with colours not their own. They are gazed at as the splendid palaces of happiness and power. But in all ages there have been a few who, measuring and sounding the rivers of the vale, at the feet of their furthest inaccessible falls, have learned that the sources must be far higher and far inward, a few who even in the level streams have detected elements which neither the vale itself nor the surrounding mountains contained or could supply. How and whence do these thoughts, these strong probabilities, the ascertaining vision, the intuitive knowledge may finally supervene, can be learnt only by the fact. I might oppose to the question the words with which Plotinus supposes nature to answer a similar difficulty. Should any one interrogate her how she works, if graciously she vouchsafe to listen and speak, she will reply, "It behoves thee not to disquiet me with interrogatories, but to understand in silence, even as I am silent, and work without words." Likewise, in the fifth book of the fifth Aeneid, speaking of the highest in intuitive knowledge, as distinguished from the discursive, or in the language of Wordsworth, the vision and the faculty divine, he says, "It is not lawful to inquire from whence it sprang, as if it were a thing subject to place and motion, for it neither approached hither, nor again departs from hence to some other place, but it either appears to us, or it does not appear, so that we ought not to pursue it with a view of detecting its secret source, but to watch in quiet, till it suddenly shines upon us, preparing ourselves for the blessed spectacle, as the eye waits patiently for the rising sun. They, and they only, can acquire the philosophic imagination, the sacred power of self-intuition, who within themselves can interpret and understand the symbol, that the wings of the air-sylph are forming within the skin of the caterpillar, those only, who feel in their own spirits the same instinct, which impels the chrysalis of the horned fly, to leave room in its involucrum for antenna yet to come. They know and feel that the potential works in them, even as the actual works on them. In short, all the organs of sense are framed for a corresponding world of sense, and we have it. All the organs of spirit are framed for a correspondent world of spirit, though the latter organs are not developed in all alike. But they exist in all, and their first appearance discloses itself in the moral being. How else could it be that even worldlings, not wholly debased, will contemplate the man of simple and disinterested goodness with contradictory feelings of pity and respect? Poor man! He is not made for this world. Oh, herein they utter a prophecy of universal fulfilment, for man must either rise or sink. It is the essential mark of the true philosopher to rest satisfied with no imperfect light, as long as the impossibility of attaining a fuller knowledge has not been demonstrated. That the common consciousness itself will furnish proofs by its own direction, that it is connected with master currents below the surface,
I shall merely assume as a postulate pro tempore. This having been granted, though but in expectation of the argument, I can safely deduce from it the equal truth of my former assertion, that philosophy cannot be intelligible to all, even of the most learned and cultivated classes. A system, the first principle of which it is to render the mind intuitive of the spiritual in man, i.e. of that which lies on the other side of our natural consciousness, must needs have a great obscurity for those who have never disciplined and strengthened this ulterior consciousness. It must in truth be a land of darkness, a perfect anti-Goshen, for men to whom the noblest treasures of their own being are reported only through the imperfect translation of lifeless and sightless motions, perhaps in great part through words which are but the shadows of notions, even as the notional understanding itself is but the shadowy abstraction of living and actual truth. On the immediate, which dwells in every man, and on the original intuition or absolute affirmation of it, which is likewise in every man, but does not in every man rise into consciousness, all the certainty of our knowledge depends, and this becomes intelligible to no man by the ministry of mere words from without. The medium by which spirits understand each other is not the surrounding air, but the freedom which they possess in common, as a common ethereal element of their being, the tremulous reciprocations of which propagate themselves even to the inmost of the soul. Where the spirit of a man is not filled with the consciousness of freedom, were it only from its restlessness, as of one still struggling in bondage, all spiritual intercourse is interrupted, not only with others, but even with himself. No wonder, then, that he remains incomprehensible to himself as well as to others. No wonder that, in the fearful desert of his consciousness, he wearies himself out with empty words, to which no friendly echo answers either from his own heart or the heart of a fellow being, or bewilders himself in the pursuit of notional phantoms, the mere refractions from unseen and distant truths through the distorting medium of his own unenlivened and stagnant understanding. To remain unintelligible to such a mind, exclaimed Schelling on a like occasion, is honour and a good name before God and man. The history of philosophy, the same writer observes, contains instances of systems which for successive generations have remained enigmatic. Such he deems the system of Leibniz, whom another writer, rashly, I think, and invidiously, extols as the only philosopher who was himself deeply convinced of his own doctrines. As hitherto interpreted, however, they have not produced the effect which Leibniz himself, in a most instructive passage, describes as the criterion of a true philosophy, namely, that it would at once explain and collect the fragments of truth scattered through systems apparently the most incongruous. The truth, says he, is diffused more widely than is commonly believed, but it is often painted, yet oftener masked, and is sometimes mutilated and sometimes, alas, in close alliance with mischievous errors. The deeper, however, we penetrate into the ground of things, the more truth we discover in the doctrines of the greater number of the philosophical sects. The want of substantial reality in the objects of the senses, according to the sceptics, the harmonies or numbers, the prototypes and ideas, to which the Pythagoreans and Platonists reduced all things, the one and all of Parmenides and Plotinus, without Spinozism, the necessary connection of things according to the Stoics, reconcilable with the spontaneity of the other schools, the vital philosophy of the Kabbalists and Hermetists, who assume the universality of sensation, the substantial forms and entelechies of Aristotle and the schoolmen, together with the mechanical solution of all particular phenomena according to Democritus and the reasoned philosophers, all these we shall find united in one perspective central point, which shows regularity and a coincidence of all the parts in the very object, which from every other point of view must appear confused and distorted. The spirit of sectarianism has been hitherto our fault and the cause of our failures. We have imprisoned our own conceptions by the lines which we have drawn in order to exclude the conceptions of others. Je trouve que la plupart des sectes ont raison dans une bonne partie de ce qu'elles avancent, mais non pas tant en ce qu'elles nient. A system which aims to deduce the memory with all the other functions of intelligence must of course place its first position from beyond the memory and anterior to it, otherwise the principle of solution would be itself a part of the problem to be solved. Such a position therefore must in the first instance be demanded, and the first question will be, by what right is it demanded? On this account I think it expedient to make some preliminary remarks on the introduction of postulates in philosophy. The word postulate is borrowed from the science of mathematics. In geometry the primary construction is not demonstrated, but postulated. This first and most simple construction in space is the point in motion, or the line. Whether the point is moved in one and the same direction, or whether its direction is continually changed, remains as yet undetermined. But if the direction of the point have been determined, it is either by a point without it, and then there arises the straight line which encloses no space, or the direction of the point is not determined by a point without it, and then it must flow back again on itself, that is, there arises a cyclical line, which does enclose a space. If the straight line be assumed as the positive, the cyclical is then the negation of the straight. It is a line which at no point strikes out into the straight, but changes its direction continuously. But if the primary line be conceived as undetermined, and the straight line as determined throughout, then the cyclical is the third compounded of both. It is at once undetermined and determined, undetermined through any point without, and determined through itself. Geometry therefore supplies philosophy with the example of a primary intuition, from which every science that lays claim to evidence must take its commencement. The mathematician does not begin with a demonstrable proposition, but with an intuition, a practical idea. But here an important distinction presents itself. Philosophy is employed on objects of the inner sense, and cannot, like geometry, appropriate to every construction a correspondent outward intuition. Nevertheless, philosophy, if it is to arrive at evidence, must proceed from the most original construction, and the question then is, what is the most original construction or first productive act for the inner sense? The answer to this question depends on the direction which is given to the inner sense. But in philosophy the inner sense cannot have its direction determined by an outward object. To the original construction of the line I can be compelled by a line drawn before me on the slate or on sand. The stroke thus drawn is indeed not the line itself, but only the image or picture of the line. It is not from it that we first learn to know the line, but on the contrary we bring this stroke to the original line generated by the act of the imagination. Otherwise we could not define it as without breadth or thickness. Still, however, this stroke is the sensuous image of the original or ideal line, and an efficient mean to excite every imagination to the intuition of it. It is demanded, then, whether there be found any means in philosophy to determine the direction of the inner sense, as in mathematics it is determinable by its specific image or outward picture. Now the inner sense has its direction determined for the greater part only by an act of freedom. One man's consciousness extends only to the pleasant or unpleasant sensations caused in him by external impressions. Another enlarges his inner sense to a consciousness of forms and quantity. A third, in addition to the image, is conscious of the conception or notion of the thing. A fourth attains to a notion of his notions. He reflects on his own reflections. And thus we may say, without impropriety, that the one possesses more or less inner sense than the other. This more or less betrays already that philosophy in its first principles must have a practical or moral, as well as a theoretical or speculative side. This difference in degree does not exist in the mathematics. Socrates in Plato shows that an ignorant slave may be brought to understand and of himself to solve the most difficult geometrical problem. Socrates drew the figures for the slave in the sand. The disciples of the critical philosophy could likewise, as was indeed actually done by Laforge and some other followers of Descartes, represent the origin of our representations in copper plates, but no one has yet attempted it, and it would be utterly useless. To an Eskimo or New Zealander, our most popular philosophy would be wholly unintelligible. The sense, the inward organ, for it is not yet born in him. So is there many a one among us, yes, and some who think themselves philosophers too, to whom the philosophic organ is entirely wanting. To such a man, philosophy is a mere play of words and notions, like a theory of music to the deaf, or like the geometry of light to the blind. The connection of the parts and their logical dependencies may be seen and remembered, but the whole is groundless and hollow, unsustained by living contact, unaccompanied with any realizing intuition which exists by and in the act that affirms its existence, which is known because it is, and is because it is known. The words of Plotinus in the assumed person of nature hold true of the philosophic energy. To theoron mu, theorema poi, osper oigeometrai, theorontes graphosin. Alemon me graphusis, therusis de uphistantai, aiton somaton grammai. With me the act of contemplation makes a thing contemplated, as the geometricians contemplating describe lines correspondent. But I not describing lines, but simply contemplating, the representative forms of things rise up into existence. The postulate of philosophy, and at the same time the test of philosophic capacity, is no other than the heaven-descended know thyself. Aesilo descendit nothis seoton, and this at once practically and speculatively. For as philosophy is neither a science of the reason or understanding only, nor merely a science of morals, but the science of being altogether, its primary ground can be neither merely speculative nor merely practical, but both in one. All knowledge rests on the coincidence of an object with a subject. My readers have been warned in a former chapter that, for their convenience as well as the writer's, the term subject is used by me in its scholastic sense as equivalent to mind or sentient being. and as the necessary correlative of object or quicquid objicitur menti. For we can know that only which is true, and the truth is universally placed in the coincidence of the thought with the thing, of the representation with the object represented. Now the sum of all that is merely objective we will henceforth call nature, confining the term to its passive and material sense, as comprising all the phenomena by which its existence is made known to us. On the other hand, the sum of all that is subjective we may comprehend in the name of the self or intelligence. Both conceptions are in necessary antithesis. Intelligence is conceived of as exclusively representative, nature as exclusively represented, the one as conscious, the other as without consciousness. Now, in all acts of positive knowledge, there is required a reciprocal concurrence of both, namely, of the conscious being, and of that which is in itself unconscious. Our problem is to explain this concurrence, its possibility, and its necessity. During the act of knowledge itself, the objective and subjective are so instantly united that we cannot determine to which of the two the priority belongs. There is here no first and no second, both are co-instantaneous and one. While I am attempting to explain this intimate coalition, I must suppose it dissolved. I must necessarily set out from the one, to which therefore I give hypothetical antecedents, in order to arrive at the other. But as there are but two factors or elements in the problem, subject and object, and as it is left indeterminate from which of them I should commence, there are two cases equally possible. 1. Either the objective is taken as the first, and then we have to account for the supervention of the subjective, which coalesces with it. The notion of the subjective is not contained in the notion of the objective. On the contrary, they mutually exclude each other. The subjective, therefore, must supervene to the objective. The conception of nature does not apparently involve the co-presence of an intelligence making an ideal duplicate of it, that is, representing it. This desk, for instance, would, according to our natural notions, be, though there should exist no sentient being to look at it. This, then, is the problem of natural philosophy. It assumes the objective or unconscious nature as the first, and as therefore to explain how intelligence can supervene to it, or how itself can grow into intelligence. If it should appear that all enlightened naturalists, without having distinctly proposed the problem to themselves, have yet constantly moved in the line of its solution, it must afford a strong presumption that the problem itself is founded in nature. For if all knowledge has, as it were, two poles reciprocally required and presupposed, all sciences must proceed from the one or the other, and must tend toward the opposite as far as the equatorial point in which both are reconciled and become identical. The necessary tendency, therefore, of all natural philosophy is from nature to intelligence, and this and no other is the true ground and occasion of the instinctive striving to introduce theory into our views of natural phenomena. The highest perfection of natural philosophy would consist in the perfect spiritualization of all the laws of nature into laws of intuition and intellect. The phenomena, the material, must wholly disappear, and the laws alone, the formal, must remain. Thence it comes that in nature itself, the more the principle of law breaks forth, the more does the husk drop off. The phenomena themselves become more spiritual, and at length cease altogether in our consciousness. The optical phenomena are but a geometry, the lines of which are drawn by light, and the materiality of this light itself has already become matter of doubt. In the appearances of magnetism, all trace of matter is lost, and of the phenomena of gravitation, which not a few among the most illustrious Newtonians have declared no otherwise comprehensible than as an immediate spiritual influence, there remains nothing but its law, the execution of which on a vast scale is the mechanism of the heavenly motions. The theory of natural philosophy would then be completed, when all nature was demonstrated to be identical in essence with that which in its highest known power exists in man as intelligence and self-consciousness, when the heavens and the earth shall declare not only the power of their Maker, but the glory and the presence of their God, even as he appeared to the great prophet during the vision of the mount in the skirts of his divinity. This may suffice to show that even natural science, which commences with the material phenomenon as the reality and substance of things existing, does yet, by the necessity of theorizing unconsciously and, as it were, instinctively, end in nature as an intelligence, and by this tendency the science of nature becomes finally natural philosophy, the one of the two poles of fundamental science. 2. Or the subjective is taken as the first, and the problem then is how there supervenes to it a coincident objective. In the pursuit of these sciences, our success in each depends on an austere and faithful adherence to its own principles, with a careful separation and exclusion of those which appertain to the opposite science. As the natural philosopher, who directs his views to the objective, avoids above all things the intermixture of the subjective in his knowledge, as for instance arbitrary suppositions, or rather sufflictions, occult qualities, spiritual agents, and the substitution of final for efficient causes, so on the other hand the transcendental or intelligential philosopher is equally anxious to preclude all interpolation of the objective into the subjective principles of his science, as for instance the assumption of impresses or configurations in the brain correspondent to miniature pictures on the retina painted by rays of light from supposed originals, which are not the immediate and real objects of vision, but deductions from it for the purposes of explanation. This purification of the mind is effected by an absolute and scientific scepticism to which the mind voluntarily determines itself for the specific purpose of future certainty. Descartes, who, in his Meditations, himself first, at least of the moderns, gave a beautiful example of this voluntary doubt, this self-determined indetermination, happily expresses its utter difference from the scepticism of vanity or irreligion. Nec tamen in scepticos imitaba, qui dubitant tantum ut dubitent, et praeter incertitudinem ipsam nihil quaerunt, nam contra totus in eo eram ut aliquid certi reperirem. Nor is it less distinct in its motives and final aim than in its proper objects, which are not, as in ordinary scepticism, the prejudices of education and circumstance, but those original and innate prejudices which nature herself has planted in all men, and which, to all but the philosopher, are the first principles of knowledge and the final test of truth. Now these essential prejudices are all reducible to the one fundamental presumption, that there exist things without us. As this on the one hand originates neither in grounds nor arguments, and yet on the other hand remains proof against all attempts to remove it by grounds or arguments, naturam foca expellas tamen usque redibit, on the one hand lays claim to immediate certainty as a position at once indemonstrable and irresistible, and yet on the other hand, inasmuch as it refers to something essentially different from ourselves, nay, even in opposition to ourselves, leaves it inconceivable how it could possibly become a part of our immediate consciousness, in other words, how that which ex hypothesi is and continues to be extrinsic and alien to our being should become a modification of our being. The philosopher therefore compels himself to treat this faith as nothing more than a prejudice, innate indeed and connatural, but still a prejudice. The other position, which not only claims but necessitates the admission of its immediate certainty, equally for the scientific reason of the philosopher as for the common sense of mankind at large, namely, I am, cannot so properly be entitled a prejudice. It is groundless indeed, but then, in the very idea, it precludes all ground, and separated from the immediate consciousness, loses its whole sense and import. It is groundless, but only because it is itself the ground of all other certainty. Now, the apparent contradiction that the former position, namely, the existence of things without us, which from its nature cannot be immediately certain, should be received as blindly and as independently of all grounds as the existence of our own being, the transcendental philosopher can solve only by the supposition that the former is unconsciously involved in the latter, that it is not only coherent but identical, and one and the same thing with our own immediate self-consciousness. To demonstrate this identity is the office and object of his philosophy. If it be said that this is idealism, let it be remembered that it is only so far idealism as it is at the same time, and on that very account, the truest and most binding realism. For wherein does the realism of mankind properly consist? In the assertion that there exists a something without them, what or how or where they know not, which occasions the objects of their perception? Oh, no! This is neither connatural nor universal. It is what a few have taught and learned in the schools, and which the many repeat without asking themselves concerning their own meaning. The realism common to all mankind is far elder and lies infinitely deeper than this hypothetical explanation of the origin of our perceptions, an explanation skimmed from the mere surface of mechanical philosophy. It is the table itself which the man of common sense believes himself to see, not the phantom of a table, from which he may argumentatively deduce the reality of a table, which he does not see. If to destroy the reality of all that we actually behold be idealism, what can be more egregiously so than the system of modern metaphysics, which banishes us to a land of shadows, surrounds us with apparitions, and distinguishes truth from illusion only by the majority of those who dream the same dream? I asserted that the world was mad, exclaimed poor Lee, and the world said that I was mad, and confound them, they outvoted me. It is to the true and original realism that I would direct the attention. This believes and requires neither more nor less than the object which it beholds or presents to itself is the real and very object. In this sense, however much we may strive against it, we are all collectively born idealists, and therefore, and only therefore, are we at the same time realists. But of this the philosophers of the schools know nothing, or despise the faith as the prejudice of the ignorant vulgar, because they live and move in a crowd of phrases and notions from which human nature has long ago vanished. O ye that reverence yourselves and walk humbly with the divinity in your own hearts, ye are worthy of a better philosophy. Let the dead bury the dead, but do you preserve your human nature, the depth of which was never yet fathomed by a philosophy made up of notions and mere logical entities. In the third treatise of my Logosophia, announced at the end of this volume, I shall give, Deo Volente, the demonstrations and constructions of the dynamic philosophy scientifically arranged. It is, according to my conviction, no other than the system of Pythagoras and of Plato, revived and purified from impure mixtures. Doctrina per tot manus tradita tandem in vapem desiit. The science of arithmetic furnishes instances that a rule may be useful in practical application, and for the particular purpose may be sufficiently authenticated by the result, before it has itself been fully demonstrated. It is enough, if only it be rendered intelligible. This will, I trust, have been effected in the following theses for those of my readers, who are willing to accompany me through the following chapter, in which the results will be applied to the deduction of the imagination, and with it the principles of production, and of genial criticism in the fine arts. Thesis 1. Truth is correlative to being. Knowledge without a correspondent reality is no knowledge. If we know, there must be somewhat known by us. To know is in its very essence a verb active. Thesis 2. All truth is either mediate, that is, derived from some other truth or truths, or immediate and original. The latter is absolute, and its formula A. The former is of dependent or conditional certainty, and represented in the formula BA. The certainty which adheres in A is attributable to B. Scholium. A chain without a staple, from which all the links derive their stability, or a series without a first, has been not inaptly allegorized as a string of blind men, each holding the skirt of the man before him, reaching far out of sight, but all moving without the least deviation in one straight line. It would be naturally taken for granted that there was a guide at the head of the file. What if it were answered, "No, sir. The men are without number, and infinite blindness supplies the place of sight"? Equally inconceivable is a cycle of equal truths without a common and central principle, which prescribes to each its proper sphere in the system of science. That the absurdity does not so immediately strike us, that it does not seem equally unimaginable, is owing to a surreptitious act of the imagination, which, instinctively and without our noticing the same, not only fills up the intervening spaces and contemplates the cycle of B, C, D, E, F, etc., as a continuous circle A, giving to all collectively the unity of their common orbit, but likewise supplies, by a sort of sub-intelligitor, the one central power which renders the movement harmonious and cyclical. Thesis 3. We are to seek, therefore, for some absolute truth capable of communicating to other positions a certainty which it has not itself borrowed, a truth self-grounded, unconditional, and known by its own light. In short, we have to find a somewhat which is, simply because it is. In order to be such, it must be one which is its own predicate, so far at least that all other nominal predicates must be modes and repetitions of itself. Its existence, too, must be such as to preclude the possibility of requiring a cause or antecedent without an absurdity. Thesis 4. That there can be but one such principle may be proved a priori, for were there two or more, each must refer to some other, by which its equality is affirmed. Consequently, neither would be self-established as the hypothesis demands. And a posteriori, it will be proved by the principle itself when it is discovered, as involving universal antecedents in its very conception. Scholium. If we affirm of a board that it is blue, the predicate blue is accidental, and not implied in the subject, board. If we affirm of a circle that it is equiradial, the predicate indeed is implied in the definition of the subject, but the existence of the subject itself is contingent, and supposes both a cause and a percipient. The same reasoning will apply to the indefinite number of supposed indemonstrable truths exempted from the profane approach of philosophic investigation by the amiable Beattie, and other less eloquent and not more profound inaugurators of common sense on the throne of philosophy. A fruitless attempt, were it only that it is the twofold function of philosophy to reconcile reason with common sense, and to elevate common sense into reason. Thesis 5. Such a principle cannot be any thing or object. Each thing is what it is in consequence of some other thing. An infinite, independent thing is no less a contradiction than an infinite circle or a sideless triangle. Besides, a thing is that which is capable of being an object which itself is not the sole percipient. But an object is inconceivable without a subject as its antithesis, omne perceptum percipientens upon it. But neither can the principle be found in a subject as a subject, contradistinguished from an object. For uniquique percipienti aliquid objicitur perceptum. It is to be found therefore neither in object nor subject taken separately, and consequently, as no other third is conceivable, it must be found in that which is neither subject nor object exclusively, but which is the identity of both. Thesis 6. This principle, and so characterized, manifests itself in the sum, or I am, which I shall hereafter indiscriminately express by the word spirit, self, and self-consciousness. In this, and in this alone, object and subject, being and knowing, are identical, each involving and supposing the other. In other words, it is a subject which becomes a subject by the act of constructing itself objectively to itself, but which never is an object except for itself, and only so far as by the very same act it becomes a subject. It may be described, therefore, as a perpetual self-duplication of one and the same power into object and subject, which presuppose each other and can exist only as antitheses. Scholium. If a man be asked how he knows that he is, he can only answer, sum quia sum. But if, the absoluteness of this certainty having been admitted, he be again asked how he, the individual person, came to be, then in relation to the ground of his existence, not to the ground of his knowledge of that existence, he might reply, sum quia deus est. Or still more philosophically, sum quia in deo sum. But if we elevate our conception to the absolute self, the great eternal I am, then the principle of being and of knowledge, of idea and of reality, the ground of existence and the ground of the knowledge of existence, are absolutely identical. Sum quia sum, I am, because I affirm myself to be, I affirm myself to be, because I am. Thesis 7. If then I know myself only through myself, it is contradictory to require any other predicate of self but that of self-consciousness. Only in the self-consciousness of a spirit is there the required identity of object and of representation, for herein consists the essence of a spirit, that it is self-representative. If therefore this be the one only immediate truth, in the certainty of which the reality of our collective knowledge is grounded, it must follow that the spirit in all the objects which it views, views only itself. If this could be proved, the immediate reality of all intuitive knowledge would be assured. It has been shown that a spirit is that which is its own object, yet not originally an object, but an absolute subject for which all, itself included, may become an object. It must therefore be an act, for every object is, as an object, dead, fixed, incapable in itself of any action, and necessarily finite. Again, the spirit, originally the identity of object and subject, must in some sense dissolve this identity, in order to be conscious of it, fit alter et idem. But this implies an act, and it follows therefore that intelligence or self-consciousness is impossible except by and in a will. The self-conscious spirit therefore is a will, and freedom must be assumed as a ground of philosophy, and can never be deduced from it. Thesis 8. Whatever in its origin is objective is likewise as such necessarily finite. Therefore, since a spirit is not originally an object, and as a subject exists in antithesis to an object, the spirit cannot originally be finite. But neither can it be a subject without becoming an object, and, as it is originally the identity of both, it can be conceived neither as infinite nor finite exclusively, but as the most original union of both. In the existence, in the reconciling, and the recurrence of this contradiction, consists the process and mystery of production and life. Thesis 9. This principium commune essendi et cognoscendi, as subsisting in a will, or primary act of self-duplication, is the mediate or indirect principle of every science. But it is the immediate and direct principle of the ultimate science alone, i.e. of transcendental philosophy alone. For it must be remembered that all these theses refer solely to one of the two polar sciences, namely to that which commences with and rigidly confines itself within the subjective, leaving the objective, as far as it is exclusively objective, to natural philosophy, which is its opposite pole. In its very idea, therefore, as a systematic knowledge of our collective knowing, scientia scientiae, it involves the necessity of some one highest principle of knowing, as at once a source and accompanying form in all particular acts of intellect and perception. This, it has been shown, can be found only in the act and evolution of self-consciousness. We are not investigating an absolute principium essendi. For then, I admit, many valid objections might be started against our theory, but an absolute principium cognoscendi. The result of both the sciences, or the equatorial point, would be the principle of a total and undivided philosophy, as, for prudential reasons, I have chosen to anticipate in the scholium to thesis 6, and the notes subjoined. In other words, philosophy would pass into religion, and religion become inclusive of philosophy. We begin with the I know myself, in order to end with the absolute I am. We proceed from the self, in order to lose and find all self in God. Thesis 10. The transcendental philosopher does not inquire what ultimate ground of our knowledge there may lie out of our knowing, but what is the last in our knowing itself, beyond which we cannot pass. The principle of our knowing is sought within the sphere of our knowing. It must be something, therefore, which can itself be known. It is asserted only that the act of self-consciousness is for us the source and principle of all our possible knowledge. Whether abstracted from us there exists anything higher and beyond this primary self-knowing, which is for us the form of all our knowing, must be decided by the result. That the self-consciousness is the fixed point to which for us all is mortised and annexed needs no further proof, but that the self-consciousness may be the modification of a higher form of being, perhaps of a higher consciousness, and this again of a yet higher, and so on in an infinite regressus. In short, that self-consciousness may be itself something explicable into something, which must lie beyond the possibility of our knowledge, because the whole synthesis of our intelligence is first formed in and through the self-consciousness, does not at all concern us as transcendental philosophers. For to us, self-consciousness is not a kind of being, but a kind of knowing, and that too the highest and furthest that exists for us. It may, however, be shown, and has in part already been shown earlier, that even when the objective is assumed as the first, we yet can never pass beyond the principle of self-consciousness. Should we attempt it, we must be driven back from ground to ground, each of which would cease to be a ground the moment we pressed on it. We must be whirled down the gulf of an infinite series. But this would make our reason baffle the end and purpose of all reason, namely, unity and system. Or we must break off the series, arbitrarily, and affirm an absolute something that is, in and of itself, at once cause and effect, causa sui, subject and object, or rather the absolute identity of both. But as this is inconceivable, except in a self-consciousness, it follows that even as natural philosophers, we must arrive at the same principle from which as transcendental philosophers we set out, that is, in a self-consciousness in which the principium essendi does not stand to the principium cognoscendi in the relation of cause to effect, but both the one and the other are co-inherent and identical. Thus the true system of natural philosophy places the sole reality of things in an absolute, which is at once causa sui et effectus, pate autopator, vios heotu, in the absolute identity of subject and object, which it calls nature, and which in its highest power is nothing else than self-conscious will or intelligence. In this sense, the position of Malebranche, that we see all things in God, is a strict philosophical truth, and equally true is the assertion of Hobbes, of Hartley, and of their masters in ancient Greece, that all real knowledge supposes a prior sensation, for sensation itself is but vision nascent, not the cause of intelligence, but intelligence itself revealed as an earlier power in the process of self-construction. Maka ilathimoi, peta ilathimoi, ei para kosmon, ei para moiran, tonson ethigon. Bearing then this in mind, that intelligence is a self-development, not a quality supervening to a substance, we may abstract from all degree, and for the purpose of philosophic construction, reduce it to kind, under the idea of an indestructible power, with two opposite and counteracting forces, which by a metaphor borrowed from astronomy, we may call the centrifugal and centripetal forces. The intelligence in the one tends to objectize itself, and in the other to know itself in the object. It will be hereafter my business to construct by a series of intuitions the progressive schemes that must follow from such a power with such forces, till I arrive at the fullness of the human intelligence. For my present purpose I assume such a power as my principle, in order to deduce from it a faculty, the generation, agency, and application of which form the contents of the ensuing chapter. In a preceding page I have justified the use of technical terms in philosophy whenever they tend to preclude confusion of thought, and when they assist the memory by the exclusive singleness of their meaning, more than they may for a short time bewilder the attention by their strangeness. I trust that I have not extended this privilege beyond the grounds on which I have claimed it, namely the conveniency of the scholastic phrase to distinguish the kind from all degrees, or rather to express the kind with the abstraction of degree, as for instance, multeity instead of multitude, or secondly, for the sake of correspondence in sound in interdependent or antithetical terms, as subject and object, or lastly, to avoid the wearing recurrence of circumlocutions and definitions. Thus I shall venture to use potence in order to express a specific degree of a power, in imitation of the algebraists. I have even hazarded the new verb potentiate with its derivatives, in order to express the combination or transfer of powers. It is with new or unusual terms, as with privileges in courts of justice or legislature, there can be no legitimate privilege where there already exists a positive law adequate to the purpose. And when there is no law in existence, the privilege is to be justified by its accordance with the end or final cause of all law. Unusual and new-coined words are doubtless an evil, but vagueness, confusion, and imperfect conveyance of our thoughts are far greater. Every system which is under the necessity of using terms not familiarized by the metaphysics in fashion will be described as written in an unintelligible style, and the author must expect the charge of having substituted learned jargon for clear conception, while, according to the creed of our modern philosophers, nothing is deemed a clear conception but what is representable by a distinct image. Thus the conceivable is reduced within the bounds of the picturable. Hinc patet, qui fiat ut cum irrepresentabile et impossibile vulgo eustem significatus habeantur, conceptus tam continui, quam infiniti, a plurimus regiciantur, quippe quorum, secundum leges cognitionis intuitivae, representatio est impossibilis. Quenquam autem harum e non paucis scholis explosarum notionum, praesertim prioris causam hic non gero, maximi tamen momendi erit monuese, gravissimo illos errore labi, qui tam perverse argumentandi ratione utuntur, quicquid enim repugnat legibus intellectus at rationis, utique as impossibile, quod autem cum rationis purae sit objectum, legibus cognitionis intuitivae, tantum modo non subest non item. Non hic dissensus inter facultatem sensitivam et intellectualem, quarum indolem mox exponam, nihil indigita nisi quas mens ab intellectu acceptas, fert ideas abstractas, illas in concreta exequi et in intuitus commutare, saepe numero non posse. Haec autem reluctantia subjectiva mentito, ut plurimum, repugnantiam adequam objectivam, et incautos facile fallit, limitibus quibus mens humana circumscribitu pro eis habitis quibus ipsa rerum essentia continetur. Critics, who are most ready to bring this charge of pedantry and unintelligibility, are the most apt to overlook the important fact that, besides the language of words, there is the language of spirits, sermo interior, and that the former is only the vehicle of the latter. Consequently, their assurance that they do not understand the philosophic writer, instead of proving anything against the philosophy, may furnish an equal and, ceteris paribus, even a stronger presumption against their own philosophic talent. Great indeed are the obstacles which an English metaphysician has to encounter. Amongst his most respectable and intelligent judges, there will be many who have devoted their attention exclusively to the concerns and interests of human life, and who bring with them to the perusal of a philosophic system an habitual aversion to all speculations, the utility and application of which are not evident and immediate. To these I would in the first instance merely oppose an authority, which they themselves hold venerable, that of Lord Bacon, non inutile scientiae existimandae sunt, quarum in se nullus as usus, si ingenia acuant et ordinent. There are others whose prejudices are still more formidable, inasmuch as they are grounded in their moral feelings and religious principles, which had been alarmed and shocked by the impious and pernicious tenets defended by Hume, Priestley, and the French fatalists or necessitarians, some of whom had perverted metaphysical reasonings to the denial of the mysteries, and indeed of all the peculiar doctrines of Christianity, and others even to the subversion of all distinction between right and wrong. I would request such men to consider what an eminent and successful defender of the Christian faith has observed, that true metaphysics are nothing else but true divinity, and that in fact the writers who have given them such just offence were sophists, who had taken advantage of the general neglect into which the science of logic has unhappily fallen, rather than metaphysicians, a name indeed which those writers were the first to explode as unmeaning. Secondly, I would remind them that as long as there are men in the world to whom the nothes seoton is an instinct and a command from their own nature, so long will there be metaphysicians and metaphysical speculations, that false metaphysics can be effectually counteracted by true metaphysics alone, and that if the reasoning be clear, solid, and pertinent, the truth deduced can never be the less valuable on account of the depth from which it may have been drawn. A third class profess themselves friendly to metaphysics, and believe that they are themselves metaphysicians. They have no objection to system or terminology, provided it be the method and the nomenclature to which they have been familiarized in the writings of Locke, Hume, Hartley, Condillac, or perhaps Dr. Reed and Professor Stewart. To objections from this cause it is a sufficient answer, that one main object of my attempt was to demonstrate the vagueness or insufficiency of the terms used in the metaphysical schools of France and Great Britain since the Revolution, and that the errors which I propose to attack cannot subsist, except as they are concealed behind the mask of a plausible and indefinite nomenclature. But the worst and widest impediment still remains. It is the predominance of a popular philosophy, at once the counterfeit and the mortal enemy, of all true and manly metaphysical research. It is that corruption, introduced by certain immethodical, aphorisming eclectics, who, dismissing not only all system but all logical connection, pick and choose whatever is most plausible and showy, who select whatever words can have some semblance of sense attached to them without the least expenditure of thought, in short, whatever may enable men to talk of what they do not understand, with a careful avoidance of everything that might awaken them to a moment's suspicion of their ignorance. This, alas, is an irremediable disease, for it brings with it not so much an indisposition to any particular system, but an utter loss of taste and faculty for all system and for all philosophy, like echoes that beget each other amongst the mountains. The praise or blame of such men rolls in volleys long after the report from the original blunderbuss. Sequacitas est potius et coitio quam consensus, et tamen quod pessimum est, pusillanimitas, ista non sine arrogantia et fastidio se offert. I shall now proceed to the nature and genesis of the imagination, but I must first take leave to notice that after a more accurate perusal of Mr. Wordsworth's remarks on the imagination, in his preface to the new edition of his poems, I find that my conclusions are not so consentient with his as, I confess, I had taken for granted. In an article contributed by me to Mr. Southey's Omniana, on the soul and its organs of sense, are the following sentences. These, the human faculties, I would arrange under the different senses and powers, as the eye, the ear, the touch, etc., the imitative power, voluntary and automatic, the imagination or shaping and modifying power, the fancy or the aggregative and associative power, the understanding or the regulative, substantiating and realizing power, the speculative reason, vis theoretica et scientifica, or the power by which we produce or aim to produce unity, necessity and universality in all our knowledge by means of principles a priori, the will or practical reason, the faculty of choice, geminisse, vilcur, and, distinct both from the moral will and the choice, the sensation of volition, which I found reason to include under the head of single and double touch. To this, as far as it relates to the subject in question, namely the words, the aggregative and associative power, Mr. Wordsworth's objection is only that the definition is too general. To aggregate and to associate, to evoke and to combine, belong as well to the imagination as to the fancy. I reply that if, by the power of evoking and combining, Mr. Wordsworth means the same as, and no more than, I meant by the aggregative and associative, I continue to deny that it belongs at all to the imagination. And I am disposed to conjecture that he has mistaken the co-presence of fancy with imagination for the operation of the latter singly. A man may work with two very different tools at the same moment. Each has its share in the work, but the work effected by each is distinct and different. But it will probably appear in the next chapter that, deeming it necessary to go back much further than Mr. Wordsworth's subject required or permitted, I have attached a meaning to both fancy and imagination which he had not in view, at least while he was writing that preface. He will judge. Would to heaven I might meet with many such readers. I will conclude with the words of Bishop Jeremy Taylor, "He to whom all things are one, who draweth all things to one, and seeth all things in one, may enjoy true peace and rest of spirit." End of chapter 12.
Chapter 13 of Biographia Literaria. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Nicole Lee. Biographia Literaria by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Chapter 13. On the Imagination or Esemplastic Power. O Adam, one Almighty is, from whom all things proceed and up to him return, if not depraved from good, created all such to perfection, one first matter all, endued with various forms, various degrees of substance, and, in things that live, of life, but more refined, more spiritous and pure, as nearer to him placed or nearer tending, each in their several active spheres assigned, till body up to spirit work, in bound proportion to each kind. So from the root springs lighter the green stalk, from thence the leaves more airy, last the bright consummate flower, spirit's odorous breathes, flowers and their fruit, man's nourishment by gradual scale sublimed, to vital spirits aspire, to animal, to intellectual, give both life and sense, fancy and understanding, whence the soul reason receives, and reason is her being, discursive or intuitive. Sane dicerentur si res corporalis nil nisi materiali continerent, verissime influxu consistere, neque habere substantiali quicquam, quem ad modum ad platonici olim recte agnovere, hinc igitur praeter pure mathematica, et fantasiae subjecta, collegi quaedam metaphysica solaque mente perceptibilia, esse admittenda et massae materiali principium, quodam superius et ut sic dicam formale addendum, quando quidem omnes veritates rerum corporearum, ex solis axiomatibus logisticis et geometricis, nempe de magno et parvo, toto et parte, figura et situ, collegi non possint, sed alia de causa et effectu, actionique et passione, accedere debeant, quibus ordinis rerum ratione salventur, et principium rerum, an entelechean, an vim appellimus, non refert, modo memenerimus per solam virium, notionem, intelligibiliter explicari. Sebo mai noerom, cufian taxin, corri timeson, u catatuthin. Descartes, speaking as a naturalist, and in imitation of Archimedes, said, "Give me matter and motion, and I will construct you the universe." We must, of course, understand him to have meant, "I will render the construction of the universe intelligible." In the same sense, the transcendental philosopher says, "Grant me a nature having two contrary forces, the one of which tends to expand infinitely, while the other strives to apprehend or find itself in this infinity, and I will cause the world of intelligences, with the whole system of their representations, to rise up before you." Every other science presupposes intelligence as already existing and complete. The philosopher contemplates it in its growth, and as it were represents its history to the mind from its birth to its maturity. The venerable sage of Königsberg has preceded the march of this master thought, as an effective pioneer in his essay on the Introduction of Negative Quantities into Philosophy, published 1763. In this he has shown that instead of assailing the science of mathematics by metaphysics, as Berkeley did in his Analyst, or of sophisticating it, as Wolff did, by the vain attempt of deducing the first principles of geometry from supposed deeper grounds of ontology, it behoved the metaphysician rather to examine whether the only province of knowledge which man has succeeded in erecting into pure science might not furnish materials, or at least hints, for establishing and pacifying the unsettled, warring, and embroiled domain of philosophy. An imitation of the mathematical method had indeed been attempted, with no better success than attended the essay of David, to wear the armour of Saul. Another use, however, is possible, and of far greater promise, namely the actual application of the positions which had so wonderfully enlarged the discoveries of geometry, mutatis mutandis, to philosophical subjects. Kant, having briefly illustrated the utility of such an attempt in the questions of space, motion, and infinitely small quantities, as employed by the mathematician, proceeds to the idea of negative quantities and the transfer of them to metaphysical investigation. Opposites, he well observes, are of two kinds, either logical, that is, such as are absolutely incompatible, or real, without being contradictory. The former he denominates nihil negativum irrepresentabile, the connection of which produces nonsense. A body in motion is something, aliquid cogitabile, but a body at one and the same time in motion and not in motion is nothing, or at most air articulated into nonsense. But a motory force of a body in one direction, and an equal force of the same body in an opposite direction, is not incompatible, and the result, namely rest, is real and representable. For the purposes of mathematical calculus, it is indifferent which force we term negative and which positive, and consequently we appropriate the latter to that which happens to be the principal object in our thoughts. Thus, if a man's capital be 10 and his debts 8, the subtraction will be the same whether we call the capital negative debt, or the debt negative capital. But inasmuch as the latter stands practically in reference to the former, we of course represent the sum as 10 minus 8. It is equally clear that two equal forces acting in opposite directions, both being finite,
and each distinguished from the other by its direction only, must neutralize or reduce each other to inaction. Now the transcendental philosophy demands, first, that two forces should be conceived which counteract each other by their essential nature, not only not in consequence of the accidental direction of each, but as prior to all direction, nay, as the primary forces from which the conditions of all possible directions are derivative and deducible. Secondly, that these forces should be assumed to be both alike infinite, both alike indestructible. The problem will then be to discover the result or product of two such forces, as distinguished from the result of those forces which are finite, and derive their difference solely from the circumstance of their direction. When we have formed a scheme or outline of these two different kinds of force, and of their different results, by the process of discursive reasoning, it will then remain for us to elevate the thesis from notional to actual, by contemplating intuitively this one power, with its two inherent indestructible yet counteracting forces, and the results or generations to which their interpenetration gives existence, in the living principle and in the process of our own self-consciousness. By what instrument this is possible, the solution itself will discover, at the same time that it will reveal to and for whom it is possible. Non omnia possumus omnes. There is a philosophic, no less than a poetic genius, which is differenced from the highest perfection of talent, not by degree, but by kind. The counteraction, then, of the two assumed forces does not depend on their meeting from opposite directions. The power which acts in them is indestructible. It is therefore inexhaustibly re-ebullient, and as something must be the result of these two forces, both alike infinite and both alike indestructible, and as rest or neutralization cannot be this result, no other conception is possible but that the product must be a tertium aliquid, or finite generation. Consequently, this conception is necessary. Now this tertium aliquid can be no other than an interpenetration of the counteracting powers partaking of both. Thus far had the work been transcribed for the press, when I received the following letter from a friend, whose practical judgment I have had ample reason to estimate and revere, and whose taste and sensibility preclude all the excuses which my self-love might possibly have prompted me to set up in plea against the decision of advisers of equal good sense, but with less tact and feeling. Dear C., you asked my opinion concerning your chapter on the imagination, both as to the impressions it made on myself, and as to those which I think it will make on the public, i.e. that part of the public who, from the title of the work and from its forming a sort of introduction to a volume of poems, are likely to constitute the great majority of your readers. As to myself, in stating in the first place the effect on my understanding, your opinions and method of argument were not only so new to me, but so directly the reverse of all I had ever been accustomed to consider as truth, that even if I had comprehended your premises sufficiently to have admitted them, and had seen the necessity of your conclusions, I should still have been in that state of mind which in your note in chapter 4 you have so ingeniously evolved as the antithesis to that in which a man is when he makes a bull. In your own words, I should have felt as if I had been standing on my head. The effect on my feelings, on the other hand, I cannot better represent than by supposing myself to have known only our light, airy, modern chapels of ease, and then for the first time to have been placed and left alone in one of our largest Gothic cathedrals in a gusty moonlight night of autumn, now in glimmer and now in gloom, often in palpable darkness, not without a chilly sensation of terror, then suddenly emerging into broad yet visionary lights, with coloured shadows of fantastic shapes, yet all decked with holy insignia and mystic symbols, and ever and anon coming out full upon pictures and stonework images of great men, with whose names I was familiar, but which looked upon me with countenances and an expression the most dissimilar to all I had been in the habit of connecting with those names, those whom I had been taught to venerate as almost superhuman in magnitude of intellect, I found perched in little fretwork niches as grotesque dwarfs, while the grotesques, in my hitherto belief, stood guarding the high altar with all the characters of apotheosis. In short, what I had supposed substances were thinned away into shadows, while everywhere shadows were deepened into substances, if substance might be called that shadow seemed, for each seemed either. Yet after all, I could not but repeat the lines which you had quoted from a manuscript poem of your own in The Friend, and applied to a work of Mr. Wordsworth, though with a few of the words altered. An Orphic tale indeed, a tale obscure of high and passionate thoughts, to a strange music chanted. Be assured, however, that I look forward anxiously to your great book on the constructive philosophy, which you have promised and announced, and that I will do my best to understand it. Only I will not promise to descend into the dark cave of Trophonius with you, there to rub my own eyes, in order to make the sparks and figured flashes which I am required to see. So much for myself. But as for the public, I do not hesitate a moment in advising and urging you to withdraw the chapter from the present work, and to reserve it for your announced treatises on the Logos, or communicative intellect in man and deity. First, because, imperfectly as I understand the present chapter, I see clearly that you have done too much and yet not enough. You have been obliged to omit so many links from the necessity of compression that what remains looks, if I may recur to my former illustration, like the fragments of the winding steps of an old ruined tower. Secondly, a still stronger argument, at least one that I am sure will be more forcible with you, is that your readers will have both right and reason to complain of you. This chapter, which cannot, when it is printed, amount to so little as 100 pages, will of necessity greatly increase the expense of the work. And every reader who, like myself, is neither prepared nor perhaps calculated for the study of so abstruse a subject so abstrusely treated will, as I have before hinted, be almost entitled to accuse you of a sort of imposition on him. For who, he might truly observe, could from your title page, to wit, My Literary Life and Opinions, published too as introductory to a volume of miscellaneous poems, have anticipated or even conjectured a long treatise on ideal realism, which holds the same relation in abstruseness to Plotinus as Plotinus does to Plato? It will be well if already you have not too much of metaphysical disquisition in your work, though as the larger part of the disquisition is historical, it will doubtless be both interesting and instructive to many to whose unprepared minds your speculations on the esemplastic power would be utterly unintelligible. Be assured, if you do publish this chapter in the present work, you will be reminded of Bishop Berkeley's Siris, announced as an essay on tar water, which, beginning with tar, ends with the Trinity, the omne scibile forming the interspace. I say, in the present work. In that greater work to which you have devoted so many years, and study so intense and various, it will be in its proper place. Your prospectus will have described and announced both its contents and their nature, and if any persons purchase it who feel no interest in the subjects of which it treats, they will have themselves only to blame. I could add to these arguments one derived from pecuniary motives, and particularly from the probable effects on the sale of your present publication, but they would weigh little with you compared with the preceding. Besides, I have long observed that arguments drawn from your own personal interests more often act on you as narcotics than as stimulants, and that in money concerns you have some small portion of pig nature in your moral idiosyncrasy, and like these amiable creatures, must occasionally be pulled backward from the boat in order to make you enter it. All success attend you, for if hard thinking and hard reading are merits, you have deserved it. Your affectionate, etc. In consequence of this very judicious letter, which produced complete conviction on my mind, I shall content myself for the present with stating the main result of the chapter, which I have reserved for that future publication, a detailed prospectus of which the reader will find at the close of the second volume. The imagination, then, I consider either as primary or secondary. The primary imagination I hold to be the living power and prime agent of all human perception, and as a repetition in the finite mind of the eternal act of creation in the infinite I am. The secondary imagination I consider as an echo of the former, coexisting with the conscious will, yet still as identical with the primary in the kind of its agency, and differing only in degree, and in the mode of its operation. It dissolves, diffuses, dissipates, in order to recreate, or where this process is rendered impossible, yet still at all events it struggles to idealize and to unify. It is essentially vital, even as all objects, as objects, are essentially fixed and dead. Fancy, on the contrary, has no other counters to play with, but fixities and definites. The fancy is indeed no other than a mode of memory emancipated from the order of time and space, while it is blended with and modified by that empirical phenomenon of the will, which we express by the word choice. But equally with the ordinary memory, the fancy must receive all its materials ready-made from the law of association. End of chapter 13.
Chapter 14 of Biographia Literaria. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Nicole Lee. Biographia Literaria by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Chapter 14. Occasion of the Lyrical Ballads, and the objects originally proposed. Preface to the second edition. The ensuing controversy, its causes and acrimony. Philosophic definitions of a poem and poetry with scholia. During the first year that Mr. Wordsworth and I were neighbours, our conversations turned frequently on the two cardinal points of poetry, the power of exciting the sympathy of the reader by a faithful adherence to the truth of nature, and the power of giving the interest of novelty by the modifying colours of imagination. The sudden charm which accidents of light and shade, which moonlight or sunset diffused over a known and familiar landscape, appeared to represent the practicability of combining both. These are the poetry of nature. The thought suggested itself,
to which of us I do not recollect, that a series of poems might be composed of two sorts. In the one, the incidents and agents were to be, in part at least, supernatural, and the excellence aimed at was to consist in the interesting of the affections by the dramatic truth of such emotions as would naturally accompany such situations, supposing them real. And real in this sense they have been to every human being who, from whatever source of delusion, has at any time believed himself under supernatural agency. For the second class, subjects were to be chosen from ordinary life. The characters and incidents were to be such as will be found in every village and its vicinity, where there is a meditative and feeling mind to seek after them or to notice them when they present themselves. In this idea originated the plan of the lyrical ballads, in which it was agreed that my endeavours should be directed to persons and characters supernatural, or at least romantic, yet so as to transfer from our inward nature a human interest and a semblance of truth sufficient to procure for these shadows of imagination that willing suspension of disbelief for the moment which constitutes poetic faith. Mr. Wordsworth, on the other hand, was to propose to himself as his object to give the charm of novelty to things of every day, and to excite a feeling analogous to the supernatural by awakening the mind's attention to the lethargy of custom, and directing it to the loveliness and the wonders of the world before us. An inexhaustible treasure, but for which, in consequence of the film of familiarity and selfish solicitude, we have eyes yet see not, ears that hear not, and hearts that neither feel nor understand. With this view I wrote The Ancient Mariner, and was preparing, among other poems, The Dark Lady and The Christabel, in which I should have more nearly realized my ideal than I had done in my first attempt. But Mr. Wordsworth's industry had proved so much more successful, and the number of his poems so much greater, that my compositions, instead of forming a balance, appeared rather an interpolation of heterogeneous matter. Mr. Wordsworth added two or three poems written in his own character, in the impassioned, lofty, and sustained diction which is characteristic of his genius. In this form the lyrical ballads were published, and were presented by him as an experiment, where the subjects, which from their nature rejected the usual ornaments and extra-colloquial style of poems in general, might not be so managed, in the language of ordinary life, as to produce the pleasurable interest which it is the peculiar business of poetry to impart. To the second edition he added a preface of considerable length, in which, notwithstanding some passages of apparently a contrary import, he was understood to contend for the extension of this style to poetry of all kinds, and to reject as vicious and indefensible all phrases and forms of speech that were not included in what he, unfortunately, I think, adopting an equivocal expression, called the language of real life. From this preface, prefixed to poems in which it was impossible to deny the presence of original genius, however mistaken its direction might be deemed, arose the whole long-continued controversy. For from the conjunction of perceived power with supposed heresy, I explained the inveteracy, and in some instances, I grieve to say, the acrimonious passions with which the controversy has been conducted by the assailants. Had Mr. Wordsworth's poems been the silly, the childish things, which they were for a long time described as being, had they been really distinguished from the compositions of other poets merely by meanness of language and inanity of thought, had they indeed contained nothing more than what is found in the parodies and pretended imitations of them, they must have sunk at once, a dead weight, into the slough of oblivion, and have dragged the preface along with them. But year after year increased the number of Mr. Wordsworth's admirers. They were found, too, not in the lower classes of the reading public, but chiefly among young men of strong sensibility and meditative minds, and their admiration, inflamed perhaps in some degree by opposition, was distinguished by its intensity, I might almost say, by its religious fervour. These facts, and the intellectual energy of the author, which was more or less consciously felt, where it was outwardly and even boisterously denied, meeting with sentiments of aversion to his opinions, and of alarm at their consequences, produced an eddy of criticism which would of itself have borne up the poems by the violence with which it whirled them round and round. With many parts of this preface in the sense attributed to them, and which the words undoubtedly seemed to authorize, I never concurred, but on the contrary objected to them as erroneous in principle, and as contradictory, in appearance at least, both to other parts of the same preface, and to the author's own practice in the greater part of the poems themselves. Mr. Wordsworth, in his recent collection, has, I find, degraded this prefatory disquisition to the end of his second volume, to be read or not at the reader's choice. But he has not, as far as I can discover, announced any change in his poetic creed. At all events, considering it as the source of a controversy, in which I have been honoured more than I deserve by the frequent conjunction of my name with his, I think it expedient to declare once for all in what points I coincide with the opinion supported in that preface, and in what points I altogether differ. But in order to render myself intelligible, I must previously, in as few words as possible, explain my views, first, of a poem, and secondly, of poetry itself, in kind and in essence. The office of philosophical disquisition consists in just distinction, while it is the privilege of the philosopher to preserve himself constantly aware that distinction is not division. In order to obtain adequate notions of any truth, we must intellectually separate its distinguishable parts, and this is the technical process of philosophy. But having so done, we must then restore them in our conceptions to the unity in which they actually coexist, and this is the result of philosophy. A poem contains the same elements as a prose composition. The difference, therefore, must consist in a different combination of them, in consequence of a different object being proposed. According to the difference of the object will be the difference of the combination. It is possible that the object may be merely to facilitate the recollection of any given facts or observations by artificial arrangement, and the composition will be a poem merely because it is distinguished from prose by metre or by rhyme or by both conjointly. In this, the lower sense, a man might attribute the name of a poem to the well-known enumeration of the days in the several months. 30 days hath September, April, June, and November, etc., and others of the same class and purpose. And as a particular pleasure is found in anticipating the recurrence of sounds and quantities, all compositions that have this charm superadded, whatever be their contents, may be entitled poems. So much for the superficial form. A difference of object and content supplies an additional ground of distinction. The immediate purpose may be the communication of truths, either of truth absolute and demonstrable, as in works of science, or of facts experienced and recorded, as in history. Pleasure, and that of the highest and most permanent kind, may result from the attainment of the end, but it is not itself the immediate end. In other works, the communication of pleasure may be the immediate purpose, and though truth, either moral or intellectual, ought to be the ultimate end, yet this will distinguish the character of the author, not the class to which the work belongs. Blessed indeed is that state of society in which the immediate purpose would be baffled by the perversion of the proper ultimate end, in which no charm of diction or imagery could exempt the Bathyllus even of an Anacreon or the Alexis of Virgil from disgust and aversion. But the communication of pleasure may be the immediate object of a work not metrically composed, and that object may have been in a high degree attained, as in novels and romances. Would then the mere superaddition of metre, with or without rhyme, entitle these to the name of poems? The answer is that nothing can permanently please, which does not contain in itself the reason why it is so, and not otherwise. If metre be superadded, all other parts must be made consonant with it. They must be such as to justify the perpetual and distinct attention to each part, which an exact correspondent recurrence of accent and sound are calculated to excite. The final definition, then, so deduced, may be thus worded. A poem is that species of composition which is opposed to works of science by proposing for its immediate object pleasure, not truth, and from all other species, having this object in common with it, it is discriminated by proposing to itself such delight from the whole as is compatible with a distinct gratification from each component part. Controversy is not seldom excited in consequence of the disputants attaching each a different meaning to the same word, and in few instances has this been more striking than in disputes concerning the present subject. If a man chooses to call every composition a poem, which is rhyme or measure or both, I must leave his opinion uncontroverted. The distinction is at least competent to characterize the writer's intention. If it were subjoined that the whole is likewise entertaining or affecting, as a tale or as a series of interesting reflections. I of course admit this as another fit ingredient of a poem, and an additional merit. But if the definition sought for be that of a legitimate poem, I answer, it must be one, the parts of which mutually support and explain each other, all in their proportion, harmonizing with, and supporting the purpose and known influences of metrical arrangement. The philosophic critics of all ages coincide with the ultimate judgment of all countries, in equally denying the praises of a just poem on the one hand, to a series of striking lines or distiches, each of which, absorbing the whole attention of the reader to itself, becomes disjoined from its context, and forms a separate whole instead of a harmonizing part, and on the other hand, to an unsustained composition, from which the reader collects rapidly the general result, unattracted by the component parts. The reader should be carried forward, not merely or chiefly by the mechanical impulse of curiosity, or by a restless desire to arrive at the final solution, but by the pleasurable activity of mind excited by the attractions of the journey itself. Like the motion of a serpent, which the Egyptians made the emblem of intellectual power, or like the path of sound through the air, at every step he pauses and half recedes, and from the retrogressive movement collects the force which again carries him onward. Precipitandus est liber spiritus, says Petronius most happily. The epithet liber here balances the preceding verb, and it is not easy to conceive more meaning condensed in fewer words. But if this should be admitted as a satisfactory character of a poem, we have still to seek for a definition of poetry. The writings of Plato and Jeremy Taylor and Burnet's theory of the earth furnish undeniable proofs that poetry of the highest kind may exist without metre, and even without the contradistinguishing objects of a poem. The first chapter of Isaiah, indeed a very large portion of the whole book, is poetry in the most emphatic sense. Yet it would be not less irrational than strange to assert that pleasure and not truth was the immediate object of the prophet. In short, whatever specific import we attach to the word poetry, there will be found involved in it, as a necessary consequence, that a poem of any length neither can be, nor ought to be, all poetry. Yet if an harmonious whole is to be produced, the remaining parts must be preserved in keeping with the poetry, and this can be no otherwise effected than by such a studied selection and artificial arrangement as will partake of one, though not a peculiar property of poetry. And this again can be no other than the property of exciting a more continuous and equal attention than the language of prose aims at, whether colloquial or written. My own conclusions on the nature of poetry, in the strictest use of the word, have been in part anticipated in some of the remarks on the fancy and imagination in the early part of this work. What is poetry? Is so nearly the same question with what is a poet, that the answer to the one is involved in the solution of the other. For it is a distinction resulting from the poetic genius itself, which sustains and modifies the images, thoughts, and emotions of the poet's own mind. The poet, described in ideal perfection, brings the whole soul of man into activity, with the subordination of its faculties to each other, according to their relative worth and dignity. He diffuses a tone and spirit of unity that blends, and as it were fuses, each into each, by that synthetic and magical power to which I would exclusively appropriate the name of imagination. This power, first put in action by the will and understanding, and retained under their irremissive, though gentle and unnoticed, control, laxis effetor habenis, reveals itself in the balance or reconcilement of opposite or discordant qualities, of sameness with difference, of the general with the concrete, the idea with the image, the individual with the representative, the sense of novelty and freshness with old and familiar objects, a more than usual state of emotion with more than usual order, judgment ever awake and steady self-possession with enthusiasm and feeling profound or vehement, and while it blends and harmonizes the natural and the artificial, still subordinates art to nature, the manner to the matter, and our admiration of the poet to our sympathy with the poetry. Doubtless, as Sir John Davis observes of the soul, and his words may with slight alteration be applied, and even more appropriately, to the poetic imagination, doubtless this could not be but that she turns bodies to spirit by sublimation strange, as fire converts to fire the things it burns, as we our food into our nature change. From their gross matter she abstracts their forms, and draws a kind of quintessence from things, which to her proper nature she transforms, to bear them light on her celestial wings. Thus does she, when from individual states she doth abstract the universal kinds, which then reclothed in diverse names and fates, steal access through the senses to our minds. Finally, good sense is the body of poetic genius, fancy its drapery, motion its life, and imagination the soul that is everywhere and in each, and forms all into one graceful and intelligent whole. End of chapter 14.
Chapter 15 of Biographia Literaria. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Nicole Lee. Biographia Literaria by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Chapter 15. The specific symptoms of poetic power elucidated in a critical analysis of Shakespeare's Venus and Adonis and Rape of Lucrece. In the application of these principles to purposes of practical criticism, as employed in the appraisement of works more or less imperfect, I have endeavoured to discover what the qualities in a poem are, which may be deemed promises and specific symptoms of poetic power, as distinguished from general talent determined to poetic composition by accidental motives, by an act of the will, rather than by the inspiration of a genial and productive nature. In this investigation I could not, I thought, do better than keep before me the earliest work of the greatest genius that perhaps human nature has yet produced, our myriad-minded Shakespeare. I mean the Venus and Adonis and the Lucrece, works which give at once strong promises of the strength and yet obvious proofs of the immaturity of his genius. From these I abstracted the following marks as characteristics of original poetic genius in general. 1. In the Venus and Adonis, the first and most obvious excellence is the perfect sweetness of the versification, its adaptation to the subject, and the power displayed in varying the march of the words without passing into a loftier and more majestic rhythm than was demanded by the thoughts, or permitted by the propriety of preserving a sense of melody predominant. The delight in richness and sweetness of sound, even to a faulty excess, if it be evidently original, and not the result of an easily imitable mechanism, I regard as a highly favourable promise in the compositions of a young man. The man that hath not music in his soul can indeed never be a genuine poet. Imagery, even taken from nature, much more when transplanted from books, as travels, voyages, and works of natural history, affecting incidents, just thoughts, interesting personal or domestic feelings, and with these the art of their combination or intertexture in the form of a poem, may all by incessant effort be acquired as a trade by a man of talent and much reading, who, as I once before observed, has mistaken an intense desire of poetic reputation for a natural poetic genius, the love of the arbitrary end for a possession of the peculiar means. But the sense of musical delight, with the power of producing it, is a gift of imagination, and this, together with the power of reducing multitude into unity of effect, and modifying a series of thoughts by some one predominant thought or feeling, may be cultivated and improved, but can never be learned. It is in these that poeta nascitur non fit. 2. A second promise of genius is the choice of subjects very remote from the private interests and circumstances of the writer himself. At least I have found that where the subject is taken immediately from the author's personal sensations and experiences, the excellence of a particular poem is but an equivocal mark, and often a fallacious pledge of genuine poetic power. We may perhaps remember the tale of the statuary, who had acquired considerable reputation for the legs of his goddesses, though the rest of the statue accorded but indifferently with ideal beauty, till his wife, elated by her husband's praises, modestly acknowledged that she had been his constant model. In the Venus and Adonis this proof of poetic power exists even to excess. It is throughout as if a superior spirit, more intuitive, more intimately conscious even than the characters themselves, not only of every outward look and act, but of the flux and reflux of the mind in all its subtlest thoughts and feelings, were placing the whole before our view. Himself, meanwhile, unparticipating in the passions, and actuated only by that pleasurable excitement which had resulted from the energetic fervour of his own spirit in so vividly exhibiting what it had so accurately and profoundly contemplated. I think I should have conjectured from these poems that even then the great instinct which impelled the poet to the drama was secretly working in him, prompting him, by a series and never broken chain of imagery, always vivid and, because unbroken, often minute, by the highest effort of the picturesque in words, of which words are capable, higher perhaps than was ever realized by any other poet, even Dante not excepted, to provide a substitute for that visual language, that constant intervention and running comment by tone, look, and gesture, which in his dramatic works he was entitled to expect from the players. His Venus and Adonis seem at once the characters themselves, and the whole representation of those characters by the most consummate actors. You seem to be told nothing, but to see and hear everything. Hence it is, from the perpetual activity of attention required on the part of the reader, from the rapid flow, the quick change, and the playful nature of the thoughts and images, and above all from the alienation and, if I may hazard such an expression, the utter aloofness of the poet's own feelings, from those of which he is at once the painter and the analyst, that though the very subject cannot but detract from the pleasure of a delicate mind, yet never was poem less dangerous on a moral account. Instead of doing as Ariosto, and as, still more offensively, Wieland has done, instead of degrading and deforming passion into appetite, the trials of love into the struggles of concupiscence, Shakespeare has here represented the animal impulse itself, so as to preclude all sympathy with it, by dissipating the reader's notice among the thousand outward images, and now beautiful, now fanciful circumstances, which form its dresses and its scenery, or by diverting our attention from the main subject by those frequent witty or profound reflections which the poet's ever active mind has deduced from, or connected with, the imagery and the instance. The reader is forced into too much action to sympathize with the merely passive of our nature. As little can a mind thus roused and awakened be brooded on by mean and indistinct emotion, as the low, lazy mist can creep upon the surface of a lake, while a strong gale is driving it onward in waves and billows. 3. It has been before observed that images, however beautiful, though faithfully copied from nature and as accurately represented in words, do not of themselves characterize the poet. They become proofs of original genius only as far as they are modified by a predominant passion, or by associated thoughts or images awakened by that passion, or when they have the effect of reducing multitude to unity, or succession to an instant, or lastly, when a human and intellectual life is transferred to them from the poet's own spirit, which shoots its being through earth, sea, and air. In the two following lines, for instance, there is nothing objectionable, nothing which would preclude them from forming in their proper place part of a descriptive poem. Behold, yon row of pines, that shorn and bowed, bend from the sea blast, seen at twilight eve. But with a small alteration of rhythm, the same words would be equally in their place in a book of topography or in a descriptive tour. The same image will rise into semblance of poetry if thus conveyed. Yon row of bleak and visionary pine, by twilight glimpse discerned, mark how they flee from the fierce sea-blast, all their tresses wild streaming before them. I have given this as an illustration, by no means as an instance, of that particular excellence which I had in view, and in which Shakespeare, even in his earliest as in his latest work, surpasses all other poets. It is by this that he still gives a dignity and a passion to the objects which he presents. Unaided by any previous excitement, they burst upon us at once in life and in power. Full many a glorious morning have I seen, flatter the mountain-tops with sovereign eye. Not mine own fears, nor the prophetic soul of the wide world dreaming on things to come. The mortal moon hath her eclipse endured, and the sad augurs mock their own presage. Incertainties now crown themselves assured, and peace proclaims olives of endless age. Now with the drops of this most balmy time my love looks fresh, and death to me subscribes, since spite of him I'll live in this poor rhyme, while he insults o'er dull and speechless tribes. And thou in this shalt find thy monument, when tyrants' crests and tombs of brass are spent. As of higher worth, so doubtless still more characteristic of poetic genius does the imagery become, when it moulds and colours itself to the circumstances, passion, or character, present and foremost in the mind. For unrivalled instances of this excellence, the reader's own memory will refer him to the Lear, Othello, in short, to which not of the great, ever-living, dead man's dramatic works, in opem M. copia fecit. How true it is to nature, he has himself finely expressed in the instance of love in his 98th sonnet. From you have I been absent in the spring, when proud pied April dressed in all its trim, hath put a spirit of youth in everything. That heavy Saturn laughed and leapt with him.
Yet nor the lays of birds, nor the sweet smell of different flowers in odour and in hue, could make me any summer story tell, or from their proud lap pluck them where they grew. Nor did I wonder at the lily's white, nor praise the deep vermilion in the rose. They were, though sweet, but figures of delight, drawn after you, you pattern of all those. Yet seemed it winter still, and you away, as with your shadow, I with these did play. Scarcely less sure, or if a less valuable, not less indispensable mark, gonimon men poeto, hostis rema genaion lakoi, will the imagery supply when, with more than the power of the painter, the poet gives us the liveliest image of succession with the feeling of simultaneousness. With this he breaketh from the sweet embrace of those fair arms which bound him to her breast, and homeward through the dark land runs apace. Look how a bright star shooteth from the sky, so glides he in the night from Venus' eye. 4. The last character I shall mention, which would prove indeed but little, except as taken conjointly with the former, yet without which the former could scarce exist in a high degree, and, even if this were possible, would give promises only of transitory flashes and a meteoric power, is depth and energy of thought. No man was ever yet a great poet, without being at the same time a profound philosopher. For poetry is the blossom and the fragrancy of all human knowledge, human thoughts, human passions, emotions, language. In Shakespeare's poems the creative power and the intellectual energy wrestle as in a war embrace. Each in its excess of strength seems to threaten the extinction of the other. At length in the drama they were reconciled, and fought each with its shield before the breast of the other. Or like two rapid streams that, at their first meeting within narrow and rocky banks, mutually strive to repel each other and intermix reluctantly and in tumult, but soon finding a wider channel and more yielding shores, blend and dilate, and flow on in one current and with one voice. The Venus and Adonis did not perhaps allow the display of the deeper passions, but the story of Lucretia seems to favour and even demand their intensest workings. And yet we find in Shakespeare's management of the tale neither pathos nor any other dramatic quality. There is the same minute and faithful imagery as in the former poem, in the same vivid colours, inspirited by the same impetuous vigour of thought, and diverging and contracting with the same activity of the assimilative and of the modifying faculties, and with a yet larger display, a yet wider range of knowledge and reflection, and lastly with the same perfect dominion, often domination, over the whole world of language. What then shall we say? Even this, that Shakespeare, no mere child of nature, no automaton of genius, no passive vehicle of inspiration possessed by the spirit not possessing it, first studied patiently, meditated deeply, understood minutely, till knowledge, become habitual and intuitive, wedded itself to his habitual feelings, and at length gave birth to that stupendous power by which he stands alone, with no equal or second in his own class, to that power which seated him on one of the two glory-smitten summits of the poetic mountain, with Milton as his compeer, not rival, while the former darts himself forth and passes into all the forms of human character and passion, the one Proteus of the fire and the flood, the other attracts all forms and things to himself, into the unity of his own ideal. All things and modes of action shape themselves anew in the being of Milton, while Shakespeare becomes all things, yet for ever remaining himself. Oh, what great men hast thou not produced, England, my country! Truly, indeed, we must be free or die who speak the tongue which Shakespeare spake, the faith and morals hold which Milton held. In everything we are sprung of earth's first blood, have titles manifold. End of chapter 15.
Chapter 16 of Biographia Literaria. This is a Librivox recording. All Librivox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit Librivox.org. Recording by Nicole Lee. Biographia Literaria by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Chapter 16. Striking points of difference between the poets of the present age and those of the 15th and 16th centuries. Wish expressed for the union of the characteristic merits of both. Christendom, from its first settlement on feudal rights, has been so far one great body, however perfectly organized, that a similar spirit will be found in each period to have been acting in all its members. The study of Shakespeare's poems, I do not include his dramatic works, eminently as they too deserve that title, led me to a more careful examination of the contemporary poets both in England and in other countries. But my attention was especially fixed on those of Italy, from the birth to the death of Shakespeare,
that being the country in which the fine arts had been most sedulously and hitherto most successfully cultivated. Abstracted from the degrees and peculiarities of individual genius, the properties common to the good writers of each period seem to establish one striking point of difference between the poetry of the 15th and 16th centuries and that of the present age. The remark may perhaps be extended to the sister art of painting. At least the latter will serve to illustrate the former. In the present age, the poet, I would wish to be understood as speaking generally and without allusion to individual names, seems to propose to himself as his main object, and as that which is the most characteristic of his art, new and striking images, with incidents that interest the affections, or excite the curiosity. Both his characters and his descriptions he renders, as much as possible, specific and individual, even to a degree of portraiture. In his diction and metre, on the other hand, he is comparatively careless. The measure is either constructed on no previous system, and acknowledges no justifying principle but that of the writer's convenience, or else some mechanical movement is adopted, of which one couplet or stanza is so far an adequate specimen, as that the occasional differences appear evidently to arise from accident, or the qualities of the language itself, not from meditation and an intelligent purpose. And the language from Pope's translation of Homer to Darwin's Temple of Nature may, notwithstanding some illustrious exceptions, be too faithfully characterized as claiming to be poetical for no better reason than that it would be intolerable in conversation or in prose, though, alas, even our prose writings, nay, even the style of our more set discourses, strive to be in the fashion, and trick themselves out in the soiled and overworn finery of the meretricious muse. It is true that of late a great improvement in this respect is observable in our most popular writers, but it is equally true that this recurrence to plain sense and genuine mother English is far from being general, and that the composition of our novels, magazines, public harangues, and the like, is commonly as trivial in thought, and yet enigmatic in expression, as if Echo and Sphinx had laid their heads together to construct it. Nay, even of those who have most rescued themselves from this contagion, I should plead inwardly guilty to the charge of duplicity or cowardice, if I withheld my conviction that few have guarded the purity of their native tongue with that jealous care which the sublime Dante, in his tract De la Vulgare Eloquenza, declares to be the first duty of a poet. For language is the armoury of the human mind, and at once contains the trophies of its past and the weapons of its future conquests. Animadvertes, says Hobbes, quam sit ab improprietate verborum pronum hominibus, prolabi in errore circa ipsas res. Sat vero, says Senatus, in hac vitae brevitate et naturae obscuritate rerum est, quibus cognoscendis tempus impendato, ut confusis et multivotis, sermonibus intelligendis illud consumere opus non sit. Ehiu, quanta strages paraveri verba nubila, quae tot dicunt ut nihil dicunt. Nobis potius, e quibus et in rebus politicis, et in ecclesia turbines et toni trua erumpunt. Et proinde recte dictum putamus a Platone in Gorgia, os an ta onomata edei, Isetai kai ta pragmata, et ab Epicteto, archai paedusios, haiton onomaton episkepsis, et prudentissime Galenus scribit, haiton onomaton crasis tarecthesia, kai tain ton pragmaton epitaratai gnosin. Egregie vero Jesi Scaliger, in Liber 1 de Plantis, es primum inquit, sapientis officium bene sentire, ut sibi vivat, proximum bene loqui ut patria vivat. As something analogous to the materials and structure of modern poetry I seem to have noticed, but here I beg to be understood as speaking with the utmost diffidence, in our common landscape painters. Their foregrounds and intermediate distances are comparatively unattractive, while the main interest of the landscape is thrown into the background, where mountains and torrents and castles forbid the eye to proceed, and nothing tempts it to trace its way back again. But in the works of the great Italian and Flemish masters, the front and middle objects of the landscape are the most obvious and determinate, the interest gradually dies away in the background, and the charm and peculiar worth of the picture consists not so much in the specific objects, which it conveys to the understanding in a visual language formed by the substitution of figures for words, as in the beauty and harmony of the colours, lines, and expression with which the objects are represented. Hence novelty of subject was rather avoided than sought for. Superior excellence in the manner of treating the same subjects was the trial and test of the artist's merit. Not otherwise is it with the more polished poets of the 15th and 16th centuries, especially those of Italy. The imagery is almost always general. Sun, moon, flowers, breezes, murmuring streams, warbling songsters, delicious shades, lovely damsels, cruel as fair, nymphs, naiads, and goddesses, are the materials which are common to all, and which each shaped and arranged according to his judgment or fancy, little solicitous to add or to particularize. If we make an honourable exception in favour of some English poets, the thoughts too are as little novel as the images, and the fable of their narrative poems, for the most part drawn from mythology or sources of equal notoriety, derive their chief attractions from the manner of treating them, from impassioned flow or picturesque arrangement. In opposition to the present age, and perhaps in as faulty an extreme, they place the essence of poetry in the art. The excellence at which they aimed consisted in the exquisite polish of the diction, combined with perfect simplicity. This their prime object they attain by the avoidance of every word which a gentleman would not use in dignified conversation, and of every word in phrase which none but a learned man would use, by the studied position of words and phrases, so that not only each part should be melodious in itself, but contribute to the harmony of the whole, each note referring and conducting to the melody of all the foregoing and following words of the same period or stanza, and lastly, with equal labour, the greater because unbetrayed, by the variation and various harmonies of their metrical movement. Their measures, however, were not indebted for their variety to the introduction of new metres, such as have been attempted of late in the Alonzo and Imogen, and others borrowed from the German, having in their very mechanism a specific overpowering tune, to which the generous reader humours his voice and emphasis, with more indulgence to the author than attention to the meaning or quantity of the words, but which to an ear familiar with the numerous sounds of the Greek and Roman poets has an effect not unlike that of galloping over a paved road in a German stage-wagon without springs. On the contrary, the elder bards both of Italy and England produced a far greater as well as more charming variety by countless modifications and subtle balances of sound in the common metres of their country. A lasting and enviable reputation awaits that man of genius who should attempt and realize a union, who should recall the high finish, the appropriateness, the facility, the delicate proportion, and above all the perfusive and omnipresent grace, which have preserved, as in a shrine of precious amber, the sparrow of Catullus, the swallow, the grasshopper, and all the other little loves of Anacreon, and which with bright though diminished glories revisited the youth and early manhood of Christian Europe in the vales of Arno and the groves of Isis and of Cam, and who with these should combine the keener interest, deeper pathos, manlier reflection, and the fresher and more various imagery which give a value and a name that will not pass away to the poets who have done honour to our own times and to those of our immediate predecessors. End of chapter 16.
Chapter 17 of Biographia Literaria. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Nicole Lee. Biographia Literaria by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. Chapter 17. Examination of the tenets peculiar to Mr. Wordsworth. Rustic life, above all, low and rustic life, especially unfavourable to the formation of a human diction. The best parts of language, the product of philosophers, not of clowns or shepherds. Poetry essentially ideal and generic. The language of Milton as much the language of real life, yea, incomparably more so than that of the cottager. As far, then, as Mr. Wordsworth in his preface contended, and most ably contended, for a reformation in our poetic diction, as far as he has evinced the truth of passion and the dramatic propriety of those figures and metaphors in the original poets which, stripped of their justifying reasons and converted into mere artifices of connection or ornament, constitute the characteristic falsity in the poetic style of the moderns, and as far as he has, with equal acuteness and clearness, pointed out the process by which this change was effected, and the resemblances between that state into which the reader's mind is thrown by the pleasurable confusion of thought from an unaccustomed train of words and images, and that state which is induced by the natural language of impassioned feeling, he undertook a useful task and deserves all praise, both for the attempt and for the execution. The provocations to this remonstrance in behalf of truth and nature were still of perpetual recurrence before and after the publication of this preface. I cannot likewise but add that the comparison of such poems of merit as have been given to the public within the last 10 or 12 years, with the majority of those produced previously to the appearance of that preface, leave no doubt on my mind
that Mr. Wordsworth is fully justified in believing his efforts to have been by no means ineffectual, not only in the verses of those who have professed their admiration of his genius, but even of those who have distinguished themselves by hostility to his theory and depreciation of his writings, are the impressions of his principles plainly visible. It is possible that with these principles others may have been blended, which are not equally evident, and some which are unsteady and subvertible from the narrowness or imperfection of their basis. But it is more than possible that these errors of defect or exaggeration, by kindling and feeding the controversy, may have conduced not only to the wider propagation of the accompanying truths, but that, by their frequent presentation to the mind in an excited state, they may have won for them a more permanent and practical result. A man will borrow a part from his opponent the more easily, if he feels himself justified in continuing to reject a part, while there remain important points in which he can still feel himself in the right, in which he still finds firm footing for continued resistance, he will gradually adopt those opinions, which were the least remote from his own convictions, as not less congruous with his own theory than with that which he reprobates. In like manner, with a kind of instinctive prudence, he will abandon by little and little his weakest posts, till at length he seems to forget that they had ever belonged to him, or affects to consider them at most as accidental and petty annexments, the removal of which leaves the citadel unhurt and unendangered. My own differences from certain supposed parts of Mr. Wordsworth's theory ground themselves on the assumption that his words had been rightly interpreted, as purporting that the proper diction for poetry in general consists altogether in a language taken, with due exceptions, from the mouths of men in real life, a language which actually constitutes the natural conversation of men under the influence of natural feelings. My objection is, first, that in any sense this rule is applicable only to certain classes of poetry; secondly, that even to these classes it is not applicable, except in such a sense as hath never by any one, as far as I know or have read, been denied or doubted; and lastly, that as far as, and in that degree in which it is practicable, it is yet as a rule useless, if not injurious, and therefore either need not, or ought not, to be practised. The poet informs his reader that he had generally chosen low and rustic life, but not as low and rustic, or in order to repeat that pleasure of doubtful moral effect, which persons of elevated rank and of superior refinement oftentimes derive from a happy imitation of the rude, unpolished manners and discourse of their inferiors, for the pleasure so derived may be traced to three exciting causes. The first is the naturalness, in fact, of the things represented. The second is the apparent naturalness of the representation, as raised and qualified by an imperceptible infusion of the author's own knowledge and talent, which infusion does indeed constitute it an imitation as distinguished from a mere copy. The third cause may be found in the reader's conscious feeling of his superiority, awakened by the contrast presented to him, even as for the same purpose the kings and great barons of yore retained sometimes actual clowns and fools, but more frequently shrewd and witty fellows in that character. These, however, were not Mr. Wordsworth's objects. He chose low and rustic life because in that condition the essential passions of the heart find a better soil, in which they can attain their maturity, are less under restraint, and speak a plainer and more emphatic language, because in that condition of life our elementary feelings coexist in a state of greater simplicity, and consequently may be more accurately contemplated and more forcibly communicated, because the manners of rural life germinate from those elementary feelings, and from the necessary character of rural occupations, are more easily comprehended and are more durable, and lastly, because in that condition the passions of men are incorporated with the beautiful and permanent forms of nature. Now it is clear to me that in the most interesting of the poems, in which the author is more or less dramatic, as The Brothers, Michael, Ruth, The Mad Mother, and others, the persons introduced are by no means taken from low or rustic life in the common acceptation of those words, and it is not less clear that the sentiments and language, as far as they can be conceived to have been really transferred from the minds and conversation of such persons, are attributable to causes and circumstances not necessarily connected with their occupations and abode. The thoughts, feelings, language, and manners of the shepherd farmers in the vales of Cumberland and Westmoreland, as far as they are actually adopted in those poems, may be accounted for from causes which will and do produce the same results in every state of life, whether in town or country. As the two principal I rank that independence which raises a man above servitude, or daily toil for the profit of others, yet not above the necessity of industry and a frugal simplicity of domestic life, and the accompanying unambitious but solid and religious education, which has rendered few books familiar but the Bible and the liturgy or hymn-book. To this latter cause indeed, which is so far accidental, that it is the blessing of particular countries and a particular age, not the product of particular places or employments, the poet owes the show of probability that his personages might really feel, think, and talk with any tolerable resemblance to his representation. It is an excellent remark of Dr. Henry Moore's that a man of confined education but of good parts, by constant reading of the Bible, will naturally form a more winning and commanding rhetoric than those that are learned, the intermixture of tongues and of artificial phrases debasing their style. It is moreover to be considered that to the formation of healthy feelings and a reflecting mind, negations involve impediments not less formidable than sophistication and vicious intermixture. I am convinced that for the human soul to prosper in rustic life, a certain vantage ground is prerequisite. It is not every man that is likely to be improved by a country life or by country labours. Education or original sensibility or both must pre-exist if the changes, forms, and incidents of nature are to prove a sufficient stimulant. And where these are not sufficient, the mind contracts and hardens by want of stimulants, and the man becomes selfish, sensual, gross, and hard-hearted. Let the management of the poor laws in Liverpool, Manchester, or Bristol be compared with the ordinary dispensation of the poor rates in agricultural villages, where the farmers are the overseers and guardians of the poor. If my own experience have not been particularly unfortunate, as well as that of the many respectable country clergymen with whom I have conversed on the subject, the result would engender more than scepticism concerning the desirable influences of low and rustic life in and for itself. Whatever may be concluded on the other side from the stronger local attachments and enterprising spirit of the Swiss and other mountaineers applies to a particular mode of pastoral life under forms of property that permit and beget manners truly republican, not to rustic life in general, or to the absence of artificial cultivation. On the contrary, the mountaineers, whose manners have been so often eulogized, are in general better educated and greater readers than men of equal rank elsewhere. But where this is not the case, as among the peasantry of North Wales, the ancient mountains, with all their terrors and all their glories, are pictures to the blind and music to the deaf. I should not have entered so much into detail upon this passage, but here seems to be the point to which all the lines of difference converge as to their source and centre, I mean as far as, and in whatever respect, my poetic creed does differ from the doctrines promulgated in this preface. I adopt with full faith the principle of Aristotle that poetry, as poetry, is essentially ideal, that it avoids and excludes all accident, that its apparent individualities of rank, character, or occupation must be representative of a class, and that the persons of poetry must be clothed with generic attributes, with the common attributes of the class, not with such as one gifted individual might possibly possess, but such as from his situation it is most probable beforehand that he would possess. If my premises are right and my deductions legitimate, it follows that there can be no poetic medium between the swains of Theocritus and those of an imaginary golden age. The characters of the vicar and the shepherd mariner in the poem of the brothers, and that of the shepherd of Greenhead Gill in the Michael, have all the verisimilitude and representative quality that the purposes of poetry can require. They are persons of a known and abiding class, and their manners and sentiments the natural product of circumstances common to the class. Take Michael, for instance. An old man, stout of heart and strong of limb, his bodily frame had been from youth to age, of an unusual strength, his mind was keen, intense and frugal, apt for all affairs, and in his shepherd's calling he was prompt and watchful more than ordinary men. Hence he had learned the meaning of all winds, of blasts of every tone, and oftentimes, when others heeded not, he heard the south make subterraneous music, like the noise of bagpipers on distant highland hills. The shepherd at such warning of his flock bethought him, and he to himself would say, "The winds are now devising work for me." And truly at all times the storm that drives the traveller to a shelter summoned him up to the mountains. He had been alone amid the heart of many thousand mists that came to him and left him on the heights. So lived he until his 80th year was past, and grossly that man errs who should suppose that the green valleys and the streams and rocks were things indifferent to the shepherd's thoughts. Fields where with cheerful spirits he had breathed the common air, the hills which he so oft had climbed with vigorous steps, which had impressed so many incidents upon his mind, of hardship, skill, or courage, joy, or fear, which like a book preserved the memory of the dumb animals whom he had saved, had fed or sheltered, linking to such acts, so grateful in themselves, the certainty of honourable gain. These fields, these hills, which were his living being, even more than his own blood, what could they less, had laid strong hold on his affections, were to him a pleasurable feeling of blind love, the pleasure which there is in life itself. On the other hand, in the poems which are pitched in a lower key, as the Harry Gill and the Idiot Boy, the feelings are those of human nature in general, though the poet has judiciously laid the scene in the country, in order to place himself in the vicinity of interesting images, without the necessity of ascribing a sentimental perception of their beauty to the persons of his drama. In The Idiot Boy, indeed, the mother's character is not so much the real and native product of a situation where the essential passions of the heart find a better soil, in which they can attain their maturity and speak a plainer and more emphatic language, as it is an impersonation of an instinct abandoned by judgment. Hence the two following charges seem to me not wholly groundless. At least they are the only plausible objections which I have heard to that fine poem. The one is that the author has not, in the poem itself, taken sufficient care to preclude from the reader's fancy the disgusting images of ordinary morbid idiocy, which yet it was by no means his intention to represent. He was even by the burr, 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 uncounteracted by any preceding description of the boy's beauty, assisted in recalling them. The other is that the idiocy of the boy is so evenly balanced by the folly of the mother, as to present to the general reader rather a laughable burlesque on the blindness of anile dotage, than an analytic display of maternal affection in its ordinary workings. In The Thorn, the poet himself acknowledges, in a note, the necessity of an introductory poem, in which he should have portrayed the character of the person from whom the words of the poem are supposed to proceed, a superstitious man, moderately imaginative, of slow faculties and deep feelings, a captain of a small trading vessel, for example, who, being past the middle age of life, had retired upon an annuity or small independent income to some village or country town of which he was not a native, or in which he had not been accustomed to live. Such men, having nothing to do, become credulous and talkative from indolence. But in a poem, still more in a lyric poem, and the nurse in Romeo and Juliet alone prevents me from extending the remark even to dramatic poetry, if indeed even the nurse can be deemed altogether a case in point, it is not possible to imitate truly a dull and garrulous discourser without repeating the effects of dullness and garrulity. However this may be, I dare assert that the parts, and these form the far larger portion of the whole, which might as well or still better have proceeded from the poet's own imagination, and have been spoken in his own character, are those which have given, and which will continue to give, universal delight, and that the passages exclusively appropriate to the supposed narrator, such as the last couplet of the third stanza, the seven last lines of the tenth, and the five following stanzas, with the exception of the four admirable lines at the commencement of the 14th, are felt by many unprejudiced and unsophisticated hearts as sudden and unpleasant sinkings from the height to which the poet had previously lifted them, and to which he again re-elevates both himself and his reader. If, then, I am compelled to doubt the theory by which the choice of characters was to be directed, not only a priori, from grounds of reason, by both from the few instances in which the poet himself need be supposed to have been governed by it, and from the comparative inferiority of those instances, still more must I hesitate in my assent to the sentence which immediately follows the former citation, and which I can neither admit as particular fact nor as general rule. The language, too, of these men has been adopted, purified indeed from what appear to be its real defects, from all lasting and rational causes of dislike or disgust, because such men hourly communicate with the best objects from which the best part of language is originally derived, and because, from their rank in society and the sameness and narrow circle of their intercourse being less under the action of social vanity, they convey their feelings and notions in simple and unelaborated expressions. To this I reply that a rustic's language, purified from all provincialism and grossness, and so far reconstructed as to be made consistent with the rules of grammar, which are in essence no other than the laws of universal logic applied to psychological materials, will not differ from the language of any other man of common sense, however learned or refined he may be, except as far as the notions, which the rustic has to convey, are fewer and more indiscriminate. This will become still clearer if we add the consideration, equally important though less obvious, that the rustic, from the more imperfect development of his faculties, and from the lower state of their cultivation, aims almost solely to convey insulated facts, either those of his scanty experience or his traditional belief, while the educated man chiefly seeks to discover and express those connections of things, or those relative bearings of fact to fact, from which some more or less general law is deducible. For facts are valuable to a wise man chiefly as they lead to the discovery of the indwelling law, which is the true being of things, the sole solution of their modes of existence, and in the knowledge of which consists our dignity and our power. As little can I agree with the assertion that from the objects with which the rustic hourly communicates the best part of language is formed, For first, if to communicate with an object implies such an acquaintance with it, as renders it capable of being discriminately reflected on, the distinct knowledge of an uneducated rustic would furnish a very scanty vocabulary. The few things and modes of action requisite for his bodily conveniences would alone be individualized, while all the rest of nature would be expressed by a small number of confused general terms. Secondly, I deny that the words and combinations of words derived from the objects with which the rustic is familiar, whether with distinct or confused knowledge, can be justly said to form the best part of language. It is more than probable that many classes of the brute creation possess discriminating sounds, by which they can convey to each other notices of such objects as concern their food, shelter, or safety. Yet we hesitate to call the aggregate of such sounds a language, otherwise than metaphorically. The best part of human language, properly so called, is derived from reflection on the acts of the mind itself. It is formed by a voluntary appropriation of fixed symbols to internal acts, to processes and results of imagination, the greater part of which have no place in the consciousness of uneducated man, though in civilized society, by imitation and passive remembrance of what they hear from their religious instructors and other superiors, the most uneducated share in the harvest which they neither sowed nor reaped. If the history of the phrases in hourly currency among our peasants were traced, a person not previously aware of the fact would be surprised at finding so large a number, which 3 or 4 centuries ago were the exclusive property of the universities and the schools, and, at the commencement of the Reformation, had been transferred from the school to the pulpit, and thus gradually passed into common life. The extreme difficulty, and often the impossibility, of finding words for the simplest moral and intellectual processes of the languages of uncivilized tribes, has proved perhaps the weightiest obstacle to the progress of our most zealous and adroit missionaries. Yet these tribes are surrounded by the same nature as our peasants are, but in still more impressive forms, and they are, moreover, obliged to particularize many more of them. When, therefore, Mr. Wordsworth adds, accordingly such a language, meaning, as before, the language of rustic life purified from provincialism, arising out of repeated experience and regular feelings, is a more permanent and a far more philosophical language than that which is frequently substituted for it by poets, who think that they are conferring honour upon themselves and their art, in proportion as they indulge in arbitrary and capricious habits of expression, it may be answered that the language which he has in view can be attributed to rustics with no greater right than the style of Hooker or Bacon to Tom Brown or Sir Roger Lestrange. Doubtless, if what is peculiar to each were omitted in each, the result must needs be the same. Further, that the poet who uses an illogical diction, or a style fitted to excite only the low and changeable pleasure of wonder by means of groundless novelty, substitutes a language of folly and vanity, not for that of the rustic, but for that of good sense and natural feeling. Here let me be permitted to remind the reader that the positions which I controvert are contained in the sentences a selection of the real language of men. The language of these men, that is, men in low and rustic life, has been adopted. I have proposed to myself to imitate, and as far as is possible, to adopt the very language of men. Between the language of prose and that of metrical composition, there neither is nor can be any essential difference. It is against these exclusively that my opposition is directed. I object, in the very first instance, to an equivocation in the use of the word real. Every man's language varies, according to the extent of his knowledge, the activity of his faculties, and the depth or quickness of his feelings. Every man's language has first its individualities, secondly the common properties of the class to which he belongs, and thirdly words and phrases of universal use. The language of Hooker, Bacon, Bishop, Taylor, and Burke differs from the common language of the learned class only by the superior number and novelty of the thoughts and relations which they had to convey. The language of Algernon Sidney differs not at all from that which every well-educated gentleman would wish to write, and, with due allowances for the undeliberateness and less connected train of thinking natural and proper to conversation, such as he would wish to talk. Neither one nor the other differ half as much from the general language of cultivated society as the language of Mr. Wordsworth's homeliest composition differs from that of a common peasant. For real, therefore, we must substitute ordinary or lingua communis, and this, we have proved, is no more to be found in the phraseology of low and rustic life than in that of any other class. Omit the peculiarities of each, and the result, of course, must be common to all. And assuredly the omissions and changes to be made in the language of rustics, before it could be transferred to any species of poem, except the drama or other professed imitation, are at least as numerous and weighty as would be required in adapting to the same purpose the ordinary language of tradesmen and manufacturers. Not to mention that the language so highly extolled by Mr. Wordsworth varies in every county, nay, in every village, according to the accidental character of the clergyman, the existence or non-existence of schools, or even perhaps, as the excitement, publican and barber happen to be, or not to be, zealous politicians and readers of the weekly newspaper Pro Bono Publico. Anterior to cultivation, the lingua communis of every country, as Dante has well observed, exists everywhere in parts, and nowhere as a whole. Neither is the case rendered at all more tenable by the addition of the words in a state of excitement, for the nature of a man's words, where he is strongly affected by joy, grief, or anger, must necessarily depend on the number and quality of the general truths, conceptions, and images, and of the words expressing them, with which his mind had been previously stored. For the property of passion is not to create, but to set in increased activity, at least whatever new connections of thoughts or images, or, which is equally, if not more than equally, the appropriate effect of strong excitement, whatever generalizations of truth or experience the heat of passion may produce, yet the terms of their conveyance must have pre-existed in his former conversations, and are only collected and crowded together by the unusual stimulation. It is indeed very possible to adopt in a poem the unmeaning repetitions, habitual phrases, and other blank counters, which an unfurnished or confused understanding interposes at short intervals, in order to keep hold of his subject, which is still slipping from him, and to give him time for recollection, or, in mere aid of vacancy, as in the scanty companies of a country stage, the same player pops backwards and forwards, in order to prevent the appearance of empty spaces, in the procession of Macbeth or Henry the Eighth. But what assistance to the poet, or ornament to the poem, these can supply, I am at a loss to conjecture. Nothing assuredly can differ either in origin or in mode more widely from the apparent tautologies of intense and turbulent feeling, in which the passion is greater and of longer endurance, than to be exhausted or satisfied by a single representation of the image or incident exciting it. Such repetitions I admit to be a beauty of the highest kind, as illustrated by Mr. Wordsworth himself from the Song of Deborah. At her feet he bowed, he fell, he lay down. At her feet he bowed, he fell. Where he bowed, there he fell down dead. Judges 1:27. End of chapter 17.